Okay, well, thanks. Thanks for persevering to the final day. What I want to do in these lectures is three things, and hopefully get to all three. The first, I want to give you a fairly high-level overview of ideas on the links between social interactions, social determinants of inequality. And in that high-level overview, I'll be very complimentary with an E and hopefully with an I to Larry Bloom's perspective, but obviously I'll say things in a somewhat different set of axes, with a somewhat different set of axes as well as different orientation. Second, I want to outline two basic ideas that I think are fundamental to the literature on social influences on inequality, and those are going to be complementarity and assortative matching in a particular sense. And then third, I want to present a paper that's not quite ready for circulation, but is it's work in progress by my colleague Anant Seshadri and I, which will be an effort to apply some of these ideas to a substantive inequality question. So the general ideas of social interactions, what I want to put on the table is it's three arguments. Okay, in other words, that efforts to introduce sociological concepts into economics or group level determinants of individual outcomes, I think can be organized into three pretty intuitive and I would say empirically plausible concepts. The first is that in the specification of the way that individuals think or make decisions, and this is the standard specification of economic theory, which presupposes that one can characterize beliefs, preferences, and constraints, then each of these cases, when one is theorizing or modeling their determination, that they are partially socially determined. So in other words, if I was to write down a description of what my preferences are, to understand those preferences, you would like to know something about the preferences of the people with whom I grew up. That would be a simple example. Another example might be that if you ask, how do I think about some phenomena, in other words, what the payoff is to having what I thought about when I was a very rational 17-year-old, and thinking about the payoffs of going to high school, how did I somehow conceptualize the benefits of graduation, that had to do with what I observed in the community that I grew up in. Or one might, to push this very differently, to keep the educational example in mind, ask, in what sense is it possible for me to achieve something if the other kids in a classroom are being very disruptive? And so all I've done is give you very trivial examples of how there could be social influences on beliefs, preferences, and constraints, and it's easy to think of elaborations that are much richer in terms of substantive behavior. So there's gonna be this idea of something about social structure mapping into these determinants of choice. What's going to give this dependence power in much of the analysis is that the interdependence is going to be structured in a particular way, and that's the notion of complementarity. And the key intuition on complementarity, first of all in reverse engineering, is that complementarity is going to say something about correlatedness of behaviors. The way that's going to occur formally is that when I write down the logic of the individual decision, and you know the basic economics, marginal cost, marginal benefits being equated, that those margins are somehow influenced by the activities or the characteristics of others. So that's really the key notion in complementarity, is that the first order conditions, which implicitly determine behaviors, have something built into them such that if others do more of something or do something, the payoff to me is marginally, or in an increasing different sense to be technical, higher than otherwise. All right, and so the key in moving from just some notion, yes, social structure matters, what others do has some influence on me, to something interesting theoretically is the particular way in which that is structured, and the standard assumption will be this notion of complementarity, which, just to keep in terms of intuition, is going to be something about how margins are affected and therefore induces a correlatedness of behavior. Now, correlatedness of behavior becomes interesting because that would tell us something about, by implication, group level inequality. So much of the discussion here, we've had this amorphous term inequality. At some level, it could be tautologically, it's just the description of a distribution of outcomes, characteristics, what have you, in a population. But that begs the question as to how we would like to organize the different facets of that in thinking about policy-relevant, ethically-relevant forms of inequality. And so if one is thinking about ethnic differences, thinking about gender differences, thinking about locational differences, these types of complementarity, because it creates correlated behaviors within social structures, at least gives us a hint as to how to think about aggregated inequality. The second idea I want to put on the table is that in many contexts, when we think about what I call memberships, in other words, location in a social structure, that location itself is determined by the presence of these social influences. So to play that out, what I'm putting on the very concrete example would be to say that parents, when they are making locational choices, what neighborhood to raise a child, are going to be responding to the fact that peer groups matter, that the local tax base matters, that role models matter, so on and so forth. So in other words, it's one thing to say that conditional on social structure, one has an argument that the nature of the distribution of outcomes is in some sense deeply influenced by that. The second idea would be that the social structure itself responds to the presence of those incentives, or of those influences. Now notice, there are clearly dimensions along which we would not want to say that the social structure is endogenous, and by which I mean we're not going to argue something like one wouldn't start by saying ethnicity is endogenous. Rather, we would take the exogenous category and ask how that interacts with the endogenous category, which is a fancy way of saying that I would want a theory of racial segregation, but the focus would be on the location of people in the neighborhoods. And so the key idea, again, is that once there are these social influences embedded in the determinants of outcomes, they have the corollary that the social structures under some dimensions, exhibit influences from them. And what becomes essential is that becomes a theory of segregation. All right. Now, segregation can be multidimensional. We want to distinguish between ethnic racial segregation versus economic segregation, so on and so forth. But in each case, there is this deep relationship between the presence of the social influences, as we shall see, and possibly complementarity in particular, and observed levels of segregation. So then I want to put these together and make the final claim, and that is that if we think about socioeconomic environments where across an individual's life course, there's a sequence of social influences, and notice in a kind of a cheap sense, I could even say the first social influence is called those two people that you are the two people who constitute the parents, moving through neighborhoods to schools to colleges to firms, that at least a perspective on thinking about inequality is to focus on how across time social factors induce segregating forces that metaphorically decouple individuals into subgroups, and that becomes a theory of persistent or intergenerational inequality in which one would think about initial inequalities developing in one generation through childhood and adolescence, leading to forms of segregation in adulthood, community, as well as location in labor markets, and that is then transmitted to children. And so, unlike a perspective that says that each of the family dynasties is directly transmitting socioeconomic status through direct investments in children or the investment of either money or time into children, what becomes key in these types of perspectives is understanding how in this socially determined environment, and notice I'm including the economy as social, in other words, the allocation of individuals across firms, what becomes essential is the way in which individuals are placed in different groups or the extent to which they're in the same group. And so the theory of persistent inequality that I put on the table, which is not meant to be a theory of everything, but a perspective, is that what's key in thinking about mobility and cross-sectional inequality is the way in which societies stratify. Okay. So that's really the what I want to have on the table, and what I've called this in some of my writings is the membership's theory of inequality. And all I mean by that, outside of having a name for it, is that one can focus on memberships as opposed to income or human capital as the object. That doesn't mean that income doesn't matter, doesn't mean human capital doesn't matter, but it focuses on a particular generative mechanism in inequality. And what I would say is particularly salient in those theories is the focus very broadly defined on segregation as a source of persistent inequality both within and across the life course.
And so when you talk about memberships, just for clarification, are you talking about neighborhood as memberships, or are you talking about racial ethnic groups?
Actually, I mean all of it. And okay. So the answer is everything. And what I mean substantively about that is a vision we could have is to start with a population of individuals. The individuals on many different dimensions have group ascriptions of form, sort of group interrelationships. Now, on top of that, I would like intensities of the feedbacks to be heterogeneous as well. But what I emphasize is that there's an interplay of many different dimensions. So to think about this, to make it concrete, one issue that one would think about is the nature of assortative mating in the proverbial marriage market. And so one vision one could have is that as there's increased assortative mating by education, that in and of itself would lower the rate of social mobility because of the transmission of the human capital, the education of the parents collectively to children. All right. Now, if I wanted to have a theory of the evolution of assortative mating by education, one of the factors I might look at is the decreased assortative mating with respect to religion or with respect to certain degrees of fineness of ethnicity. So the notion that German Catholics married German Catholics, as they typically did in 1848 or whenever my ancestors showed up. The serious point being that was a salient category for a very long time in the United States. That's no longer a salient category. And so in other words, the degree of fineness of that reduces, other things are left over. That's all I want on the table. That would be idea number one. Idea number two now is neighborhoods. We could think about how children are located in different communities. Those communities will have different levels of affluence or disadvantage, and one has a whole plethora of social influences there. All right, now notice I'm talking now about endogenous memberships. Third example would be schools. And there I want to transit from neighborhoods per se to higher education, the whole process by which assignment rules are created by schools. That's a fancy name, that's the econo name for admissions policies. That's determining the degree to which students are segregated by income, or maybe I should say segregated by test scores, by high school achievement, et cetera. And then but notice there the segregations with respect to different factors. And then if I finally looked at these objects called firms, once again, we could think about the labor markets as having what I called a social aspect, not in the sense that it's not economic, but rather part of what determines the productivity of an individual is the co-workers. And so, again, in each case, there's going to be different dimensions along which we might think about segregation. I started off by saying segregation of parents with educational similarities versus, over here, segregation of skill types. But in each case, it's going to be the same idea of segregation and something about interactions. Now notice that what I would then do is superimpose on my endogenous sequence the exogenous group identities, such as of which obviously I have gender and ethnicity in mind, and that would be how one would instantiate a full-blown model. Okay. So I really want to say three things about why think this way. Okay. I think three benefits. The first is that I think it is a good faith effort by economists to introduce sociological social ideas into economic models. Now, I think a sociologist could have two reactions, both of which are correct. The first is, we've known that forever. That's true. But you gotta give people credit for trying to catch up. And the second point is to ask a question which has to do with the role of economic modeling relative to the ideas. And here I think what I would emphasize is it's an effort to introduce these substantive ideas into the formalism of economic theory, in which there's going to be natural trade-offs. The richness of the theories is obviously greater in a verbal description than its mathematical instantiation. On the other hand, there's the usual arguments for what a mathematical formulation does in terms of allowing one to be rigorous about the logical coherence of ideas, work out general equilibrium implications, so on and so forth. But I want to emphasize, I think it really is an effort to break standard boundaries. The second thing I want to say is that there is a sense in which these models are often deviations from, I shouldn't have written neoclassical theory of choice. What I should have said is the Arrow-Debreu model. And what I mean by that is the environments that are studied typically do not have, quote unquote, complete frictionless markets. There are spillover effects. There's no market that paid somebody to be a good, or I didn't pay anybody to be a role model for my my children to live in that neighborhood. Now, the neighborhood had prices. Those were the members, those were the admissions prices called housing, housing prices. But nevertheless, one doesn't have this notion of completeness. A lot of the formulation comes in terms of non-compensated or it comes in forms of externality. So that's something just to keep in mind. The third point, and this is not necessary to the broad literature, but it's kind of how my own work looks, and I'd say, and many other papers, is that it very much preserves the core logic of methodological individualism, by which I mean nothing more than we start with the specification of individual behaviors and outcomes and then look at what happens in the aggregate. So if one's going to talk about the disparity in smoking rates between different subgroups of teenagers, those are emergent as simply statistical regularities. Now, I emphasize that because one of the issues in being very careful to preserve heterogeneity of populations, I want to say two things. One is that in translating theories into econometric analogs, starting with environments in which one's been careful to allow for unobserved heterogeneity has a very big advantage. It means that the analogy between the theoretical model and the statistical model, the econometric model, is going to be much stronger because we've started reasoning ex ante from the notion that there are things that an analyst doesn't know and treats as random variables, and that, of course, is nothing more than the errors, so to speak, that we put in the models. And then I think the second point is substantive, and that is that a lot of this literature is trying to address these, you know, things such as poverty traps, the idea that there are states, configurations in populations where individuals, it's extremely difficult to escape. But with that, but one does want to avoid a mechanistic view that if somebody is growing up in a very bad neighborhood, that's it, that it's an absorbing state, because that's going to miss very important aspects of family resilience as well as, you know, forms of both upward and downward mobility. And so I think, so I put it on the table. It's just, if I say something is aesthetic, I actually consider that a high compliment. Now, theory has to have the right aesthetics. And part of what one wants in these theories, seriously, is a respect for individual heterogeneity that allows for individuals not to be, as I said, mechanically controlled by a social environment. Okay. So we've already, throughout the lectures, talked about social influences. Peer group effects are, in some ways, the most common one. There are different ways to motivate peer group effects. Theoretically, I think that much of the literature implicitly is treating conformity as a psychological primitive. In other words, that we evolved as creatures, and one of the templates in our minds is that in different contexts, there's a tendency to wish to conform to the behavior of others. There are evolutionary psychology arguments for those types of things. I happen not to be terribly interested in those, since it's not clear from evolutionary psychology whether I get a theory of bigotry from those tendencies or a theory of why I root for the LA Dodgers. In other words, the manifestations of the evolutionary psychology into actual behaviors is sufficiently tenuous that I don't think that's an important thing to focus on per se, but nevertheless, the literature treats it as a primitive. Another example would be role models. In other words, the idea that in communities, and this obviously has the intergenerational flavor, that there's something about the distribution of adults, what they do, what they've achieved, what they failed to achieve, so on and so forth, that's mapping into how children think about the world. Another example would be social norms, and that is a very logically distinct phenomenon that works at a different level. And the final one, simply social learning, which I've already referred to, the idea that the data which I accumulate to think about the world's generated by who I interact with. Please.
So
Yes. Oh, yes, that's a very important point. Thank you. I want to draw the following distinction. It's one thing to write down a model that has social influences. I'm saying, as a matter of theory about social interactions, the literature will focus on cases in which the manifestation is in a form of complementarity. But there's no guarantee of that. And in a number of environments, it's quite clear that would be a bizarre assumption. I will give an example in a little bit. I'll give examples of that as I go through some phenomena. Okay, but that's a very important point. The distinction I want to draw is one thing to say, when I specify the trio of determinants of individual behavior, I build in social aspects to that. A second is to ask, what is the structure of that social dependence? And when it's complementarity, certain things happen, and that's what the literature, in some sense, has been focused on. So here are some of the examples where models of social interactions have been applied. One example is fertility, understanding the heterogeneity in fertility, in other words, the number of children different individuals have, as well as the marital status of the birth parents at the time. That's a natural place where one would think about social norms, one would think about peer influences, conformity, and the like. And so there's a pretty complicated, rich literature looking at that. A second example would be education, thinking about the social determination of effort in high school or graduation rates, so on and so forth. A third example has been talked about, which is employment. There, the focus tends to be on information flows, how it is that openings for jobs are influenced by my information about them is determined by who I know. I referred to health as an example already when I talked about cigarette smoking. And so an example there is that if you take American teenagers and you divide them by ethnicity and gender, there's very substantial heterogeneity in the smoking rates. And what I would put on the table is it's actually quite difficult to explain the heterogeneity with the usual suspects, which would be the prices of cigarettes, the educational level of the parents, whether the parents smoke, etc. And so the upshot of that literature, I think, is quite credibly shows that there's, it won't be shocks to those of you that remember being teenagers, for example, that one is influenced by whether your friends smoke. It's a very social activity. Now, what I wanted to focus on, because of yours, is language. So I'm going to ask a question, and I want to say it a certain way, and then get to language. It is a fact that in the U.S. economy, there are millions of people who speak a form of English that is no less rule-based and no less comprehensible than mine in any respect. But nevertheless, this particular form of English, there is very strong evidence, is costing them very substantial income in labor markets. That's a question, isn't it? After all, and of course, I'm referring to African-American vernacular English. There's very interesting studies showing that in interviews, if you have a white interviewer and somebody comes in, the way that they're speaking, even though it's perfectly comprehensible, there's no issues about that, that is influencing the way in which the candidate's assessed. All right. So one thing one would do as a theorist, or as a theorist then looking at data, is ask questions about statistical discrimination. In other words, why is stereotyping going on in response to dialect choice? A different question is to ask why the dialects are persistent. And I mean that in two senses. One of them, how is it that different communities end up with slightly, as I said, unimportant in a linguistic sense differences in pronunciation or in grammar? These are purely social phenomena. And so that's the sort of thing one can play out. In other words, to try to understand how different subgroups in a population end up with, as I said, with different dialects. One would then superimpose on that a different question, which is what about what in sociolinguistics is called code switching? You probably know this. There's a kind of a story about you go to Oxford and there'll be somebody speaking in the nice BBC English, but when they go home, they have a Cockney accent. That's all code switching means. And I'm sure you all know people where you've heard them in different contexts sound very different. That's a separate social question. Why is it that everybody doesn't do that so that they get rid of all what I've called the labor market discrimination associated with dialect? These are simply, and so what I put on the table is that these are things where we might want to think about the social determinants of behavior. So to give you a hint as to how one might proceed in these things, here's a statistical regularity. If you look in English-speaking countries, Britain, the United States, New Zealand, some people pronounce the word going, G-O-N-I-N-G, ing. Others say going. What would predict whether or not one uses going or going? It tends to be poor white males drop the G. So how would one then, so I put that on the table. That's your question. What I want at least to sensitize to is that language is very much wrapped up in personal identity. So the notion that one can always strategically choose the correct dialect to maximize labor market outcomes isn't respecting the psychology that makes language so intimate into a sense of personal identity. I gave you the example of the poor white males because the conventional sociolinguistic explanation, which I think has much purchase, is that poor white males, remember I said they're all English-speaking countries. Among the many virtues of English-speaking countries is America, Britain, we like money, right? So these are societies in which economic status is very salient. And so what might happen to people who, by the norms of the society, are looked down upon because they're not successful? They may want to reject the society. That's your example. In other words, a rich model of linguistic identity would say that people who feel disrespected may reject the majority pronunciation of a language, right? And if I were to go through, you know, issues of thinking about African American vernacular English, then there would be a much more complicated story in which you have to ask how it is that a community survives and how identities evolve in response to, you know, invidious stereotypes and discrimination across centuries. Right? And so I put language on the table and emphasized it for several reasons. One, I think economists don't study it enough. I think it's very important in understanding issues of interactions and what the manifestations are in markets and other cases. Second, it's an example where the complementarity idea actually breaks down. Because in order to wish to identify with some others, I have to not identify with some others, and therefore we get a more complicated environment than strict complementarity. Please.
Mm-hmm. But now in the era of social media, where you are bombarded with information all over the world, how do you determine what are the factors that will have more influence than others?
So that I think I'm going to largely hold off on, in the sense that what you're asking about is the nature of communication flows at different levels of universality. I will say the following, that there is not evidence that the rise of mass media homogenized regional accents or dialects. Okay. That these are extremely persistent phenomena. And you would say, why am I making such a big deal about language? Keep in mind that countries such as Belgium are on the verge, are border on dissolution over one, issues of language. Obviously, Quebec and Canada have had similar issues. I don't want to reify language as the only cultural distinction, but this is very, very powerful in terms of how people interact with one another. And what I would emphasize there is the persistence of the heterogeneity, despite the homogenization that occurs with mass media. Okay, it's just something I want on the table. Again, these are just things to think about. Why is it? Are there tendencies? Are there mechanisms? Are there forces, whatever you want to call them, which create heterogeneities of these types? And do they have manifestations in terms of economic outcomes? Final one. I'll say to a couple of comments about. Which is evolution of science. So here's a question would be the following, which is how do scientific communities move from one set of theories to another? What the philosopher of science Philip Kickscher called the legend is that the truth seekers sit in their offices, you know, economists, of course, and social scientists, we're all truth seekers, so we sit in our offices by ourselves, we weigh the evidence. When one theory looks better, we, of course, all jump over. So-called sociology of scientific knowledge, which has various manifestations, of course, wants to argue about the role of incentives that are non-epistemic for scientific theory. But the serious question is, how do communities move? How did rational expectations become the standard assumption in macroeconomics? Well, the answer is that we would want to think about environments in which individual researchers are weighing evidence against backgrounds of theories, but we'd also want to respect the fact that a scientific community is a community in which there's many incentives. Those incentives, I hate to bring one of them up, include publishing in top five journals. Another incentive is research grants. Another incentive is that if you're in a group of in a department, you're assistant professor, maybe the senior professors have state, you know, they're less likely to be open to new theories, and they're the ones who are making the assessments. Well, one can actually formalize all of this and write down dynamic models of how communities move across scientific theories as evidence and social factors interact. Okay. And so the reason I put that again on the table is something that's a little bit unorthodox is that these can, you know, there's many questions in which at the end of the day we're interested in trading off different factors. And what the formalization does is allow one to embody the notion that there's a set of factors. They may move people in different directions individually, and we want to know what the aggregate consequences are. All right. So again, you know, I've already referred to the groups that I want to focus. I think about one of them would be neighborhoods. That's my own research tends to focus on neighborhoods. I think firms are extremely interesting. My modest student, Kuyen, is working on exactly that question, which is asking how evolution of technology alters the degree of segregation by skill across firms. I think that that's an important, under-researched aspect of technological change. There's lots of discussion of skill-biased technological change as explaining why there's disparity in wages. In other words, whatever skills people have that's unobserved are receiving higher and higher premia. A separate question, which is the one that she's exploring, which I think is very important, is how does technological change alter who interacts with who? So there I would put on the table the distinction between the paradigmatic 1950s organization, General Motors, in which assembly line workers, engineers, accountants, and managers, for better or worse, they were in the same production function. Distinguish that from Apple. Apple is a configuration of extraordinarily skilled people with relatively little input from other types of workers. And further, and this is back to the globalization question, the production function associated with a smartphone does not require locational proximity. That's a way one can think about what it means to have globalization / offshoring, is that the production functions in the economy no longer have to be conditioned by location. And so again, what I put on the table is if we think about something such as technical change and the evolution towards these information technologies, one can again have a vision in which segregation becomes a key way to think about the inequality. Now, I want to emphasize that much of the ethically salient, the inequality that we particularly care about, is driven by groups in which we don't naturally think about their endogeneity. And that, of course, is ethnicity, gender, and religion. Now, when I say we don't think about the endogeneity, I'm not literally saying nobody can change his or her religion, for example. What I'm saying is something different. And that is, if I want to have a theory of how a phenomena affects total inequality, in some cases, I need to account for the endogeneity of the social structure. It's not enough to say neighborhoods affect children. If I want it to be a theory of inequality, I have to explain the stratification by income or the segregation by income and race across the neighborhoods. In contrast, a theory of ethnic and of black-white inequality, I would take as given these categories and ask what the manifestations are with respect to the phenomenon of interest. So that to me is the endogenous-exogenous distinction, is simply asking when is the theory complete if I condition on certain categories or not. Here's a question that's actually not understood. Oh, I want to make actually two comments. One of them, and this is kind of something Larry brought up, often models of social interactions don't deal with intensity very well. In other words, whites interact with whites, blacks interact with blacks, men with men, women with women, and don't respect the heterogeneity of the social structures within those groups. That's kind of a general observation. The second comment, which is really, really more relevant to this, is we don't really have theories, and this is for those of you that are theoretically oriented, to ask why are certain group memberships salient? In other words, if I make an argument that role models are driven by gender and ethnicity, that doesn't answer the question why. After all, I could give you other predetermined things such as eye color that could define group interactions. We don't talk about how all the hazel-eyed people are creating social interactions for one another, so on and so forth. And so we don't actually have a theory of salience. It may be we don't need one. I'm intentionally contradicting myself. In other words, I think it would be theoretically interesting if we could somehow characterize why certain things become salient. When I say I'm not sure we need one, is it may be that at the end we would conclude that it's historically, it really is all driven by historical contingency. It is the history of the United States that made black-white differences salient here in a way they are not salient in other societies. And so I don't know the answer to that, but I put that on the table as something a theorist might be interested in. Okay. So let me just make a couple of comments about what I think of as the structure of social interactions. And if we're going to write down the textbook model of economic behavior, you know, a typical way we would just do that, you know, the algebra for where you say there's some outcome, which you're indexing by individual, I call them choices. The choices live in a constraint set. The constraint set may be predetermined. If it's a binary choice, there's only two things in there. I like to code them -1 and 1, so those are the constraint set. It's just you do one of the things. Otherwise, it could be a budget set if it was a case where you had an income and there were prices. And this is what I meant, that just as a tautology, we would always think about these choices as determined by the characteristics of individuals, their description, and I want to be careful in dividing those characteristics into the things I want to treat as observable and the things that I want to treat as unobservable, not to the actors, but to me. And so what I call the textbook, the introductory economics model, is simply that, which is to say that we think of an individual as having some preference ordering, which is described as a utility function, that depends on the choice, it depends on the two types of heterogeneity, and by definition, tautologically, I interpret every choice as maximizing the utility function subject to the constraint set. What moves us from a tautology, when I say a tautology, anything I observe, I can always say that's maximizing utility. What gives a theory content is the way that we model the preferences and the way we model the constraints. So when I talk about social interactions models, all I'm saying is that each individual is in a group. And so that, you know, and it's not necessarily the case that any two people have identical groups. In other words, I could even have a fine enough gradation of the categories of individuals so that we're all unique. But so, you know, along the gender dimension, I'm with some people. Along the hair dimension, I'm with some people, a smaller number in this classroom than I'm typically used to, so on and so forth. And then, but my group is defined by all the people I interact with and the weights I assign to them. Okay. So what I want to say is that with respect to me, each group has some set of characteristics. So it could be the fraction of my friends that have less hair than me. Well, that's a null set. So let's say the fraction that are let's say within 50% of me in terms of total coverage. So I want to have a meaningful set, or it could be the percentage my best friend. That's another group. In other words, the behavior of my best friend. That's another characteristic of the group. So on and so forth. I also want to add to that that not only do the people in my group all have characteristics, and collectively the group has those characteristics influence me, their behaviors influence me. And the way that I want to describe that is to say I have some beliefs about what they're going to do. I'm going to call them subjective. That's not very interesting, because all I'm saying is they're beliefs. I could have perfect foresight. I actually talk to my friends. Or it could be I'm thinking about when I was 17, what were my friends going to wear the senior year of high school, and what shirts I should be buying. By the way, and the answer I'm embarrassed to say was half cowboy, half Hawaiian. San Fernando Valley, what can I say? All right, whatever it is, I might have had beliefs, I don't observe that. And those beliefs in turn, they may be rational in the mathematical sense, by which I mean they're consistent with the logic of the specification of the environment, or they could just be any heuristic you want for belief formation. I go through that only because I want to say at the end, I would write down the same tautological description of behaviors as I did before, except I would expand the way that I describe preferences and constraints. Please.
How in the definition of group, how would, when you talk about salience, different groups, like you have groups in different dimensions, how would that map into that framework?
So the trick was that I gave each person his or her own group. So my group is the white male without the hair. So I know that's who I am, and therefore my group is all the people that fit in one of those categories, or if those are the only categories that influence me, and then conditional on knowing who influences me, each person gets a weight. Well, that's the description of my YGI.
So you have assumed which group is the
important
one.
Is
the important one in that frame?
I don't have, yeah, what I'm saying, no, I'm not making it, I'm saying there is a group that's the most important one. There's a special case of this. The group's everybody. So I'm saying whatever it is, each individual, this is just sort of logic of getting the memberships theory language back in, which is that I can think of individuals as partitioning the population to those that influence them and those that do not. Okay, now you might say, is that an artificial distinction? You know, that's a separate matter. I just want it as a thought experiment. And then I could say that I'm a member of a group which I may build up because of my multiple identities. But then at the end of the day, what matters are the weights I assign to others. Please.
So in general, you can define your group as any function of my characteristics and my characteristics and choices and the characteristics.
Yes. Yes. Yes, there's less than meets the eye here. I just wanted to preserve the language of thinking about being members of social structures. Yeah, so I'm saying whatever it is not that I have to know it. It's a fact, and that's what influences me. And so what I want to emphasize is that, and there's a tendency in some of this work which spills over into work on economic complexity and stuff to claim this is some new paradigm and you know profoundly heterodox economics. I don't think any of that's right. In other words, it's using the same, what I call the methodological individualism of economic theory, that you specify how individuals have outcomes via the logic of beliefs, preferences, constraints, and then you introduce some concept of equilibrium to describe a population. What's new here is what we think are the constituents of the beliefs, preferences, and choices. Okay. So, some allusions have been made to theoretical properties of these models. I want to give my own take on them. One of the properties the models will have is something that's been referred to as social multipliers. And so the thought experiment to have here is that I could take a high school and suppose that I give one student a promise that you will receive a full scholarship to college if you get your degree. There'll be some effect on the incentive, right? Well, what happens if I make the same promise to every student in the high school? Could I simply scale up the individual incentives to conclude what the collective incentive is? The answer would be no. If there's social factors, then there would be a multiplier effect. If you two are friends, I gave him the scholarship that influenced you. I gave you a scholarship that influenced, actually, they were in high school together, so I should pick them together. I'm sorry. Matter of fact, that may explain why you're here. Okay, so you talk about a social interaction effect. But the point is that you could see how when you introduce alterations in incentives and look at the equilibrium effects, the social interdependences can scale up the influences, and that's an interesting thing to know, both in a positive sense, but it also has policy implications. Because after all, it tells us that the general equilibrium bang for buck can't be extrapolated off of very isolated interventions. Now, there's special cases where it can, but in general, you can't. The second comment, and the logic is going to come, this is very similar, is that these models can exhibit multiple equilibria. Multiple equilibria means that when I specify how individuals make choices or how the decisions occur, there is more than one configuration of the population choices compatible with the same specification of the microeconomic foundations. And to sort of see how this could be, you know, it's very easy to give intuitive examples for that. If it turns out, so Moshe's terrified of me because, you know, he talks to me about his work, and I'm terrified of him, actually. So the way that it works, and every time we get together, if he's friendly, I'm going to be friendly because I'll be so happy. But if he's not friendly, I'm going to be unfriendly because I'm so hurt. Same thing for him. So what happens every time we meet? Well, either we're both friendly or we're both unfriendly. You see, the point is the following, and that is that if my incentives are sufficiently sensitive to what you do, and yours are the same for me, that's almost a degree of freedom in the logic of the equilibrium. That's all multiple equilibria are going to come down to in these environments, and that's why complementarity is so intimately related to them. Okay, so the social multipliers derive, you know, quite generally from the structure of the social, the presence of the social phenomena. When they are, in some sense, the social phenomena are strong, we end up with this possibility of multiple equilibria. Okay. And then the third idea is a so-called phase transition. So let in an example of a phase transition is if you take the substance called H2O and you put it in an environment in which there's an external thing called the temperature. If the temperature is at 32 degrees Fahrenheit plus epsilon, a little bit warmer, the substance is called water. If it's a little bit below, it's called ice. And so the serious point is that water exhibits a phase transition from liquid to solid according to temperature. That's one canonical example. All right. What is phase transition is a mathematical property, says that systems have certain characteristics, an equilibrium description. And there'll be parameter values where for some threshold, if you're a little bit below it, you get a qualitatively different description of the environment than if you're above it. Now that becomes, that clearly becomes an object, is potentially an object of interest. So what will happen in social interactions models is suppose I have a parameter that metrizes complementarity, measures it. I started at zero. We just go in and make our independent choices. If I set the parameter off to infinity, it is with certainty we're going to be perfectly correlated. And so if we sort of had it, so think about it this way. Every day we wake up in a good mood or a bad mood. All right, so my decision on how to act is going to be a function of the flip of my mood plus the strength of the complementarity. If it's zero, every day we walk in, there are two coins flipped, right? So it's 50-50, we'll be doing each of the four configurations. As the complementarity parameter increases at infinity, there's only two configurations that can occur. And so what's going to happen intuitively, if you think about it, I said there's a parameter to index this. We start off with the description in repeated interactions. Half the time we're nice, half the time we're not nice when there's no complementarity. Otherwise, what we know, and we don't, there'll be no correlation between us. We know in the limit we're perfectly correlated. As I start J at zero and move it up, something's going to change. In other words, that polarization, and that's the phase transition. Please. I'm thinking of this more in a cross-sectional sense, which is that I look at the environment with low complementarity. There'll be a unique equilibrium. There'll be a parameter that indexes complementarity. What I could do is graph the number of equilibria against the value of the complementarity parameter. So it's going to be 1, 1, 1, 1. It'll be a 1, and then suddenly it goes to 2. And so that's the sense in which I'm thinking of the phase transition. The key intuition is that complementarity doesn't guarantee multiple equilibria. They have to be strong enough so that in some sense what's happening is self-consistent bunching of behaviors is an equilibrium. There's more than one of them that's going to work. So if I offered everybody $10,000, if your behavior is perfectly correlated with $100 million, what the heck, you get to these big Chicago donors. Everybody gets $100 million if the behaviors in here are unanimous. They will be unanimous. I don't know what they're going to be. If I offered everybody a half of a cent to do, a one penny to do it, it has no effect. It would have no interesting effect on the equilibrium. That's really what I'm saying. Here's the big idea. The formal models will represent an interplay of three forces. Force number one will be the distribution of the private incentives that we have for behaviors. That's what I call the first model. Force number two will be the social incentives. Those are the aspects of the preference ordering that depend on others' characteristics or choices. To get multiple equilibria, in some sense, the social things have to be potentially very powerful compared to the private things. That's idea number one. Idea number two. When I think about quote-unquote private things, the private incentives, I want to distinguish between their first moment and the higher moments. So what do I mean by that? One question that would be of interest to me is the following, and that is, suppose I raise private incentives uniformly, what happens? That's what I'm calling a common component. So if I said to you, why does Beverly Hills High School have a high graduation rate? I'm not gonna say, oh, it's because they all coordinated on the good equilibrium. No, it's because the incentives to graduate are so high. End of discussion, right? There's not, we don't need a social theory for that. A distinct question is to ask, what happens to the equilibrium average if I raise the dispersion of the individual incentives? And so a concrete way to think about that, it's one thing to raise everybody's incentive, but what if I sort of cause the population to have a fatter tailed distribution of incentives? So there's some people over here that really have an incentive to make choice A, and some people that really have an incentive over here to make choice B. That's a distinct way to think about changing private incentives, isn't it? Turns out that also changes the number of equilibria. So idea number one, intense social interactions, you can see how private incentives, if they kind of move everybody towards doing something, they can swamp the possibility of multiple equilibria. But the other thing, and this is maybe the one that's less obvious, heterogeneity in incentives also can kill off multiple equilibria. And why is that? Because if I take a population and half the population got that draw, that epsilon that makes them as good an economist as Kenneth Arrow, and the other half got a, so the way that draws work is with a high probability you're either as good an economist as Arrow or as good a composer as Beethoven, I'm not going to worry about the social determinants of occupation, am I? The serious point is that when there's very strong, large heterogeneity means the fraction of the population whose choices are controlled, quote unquote, are determined by the idiosyncratic or the private incentives is high enough, there aren't enough people left over to engage in self-consistent reinforced bunching. Okay. Now, notice what I did. I actually threw a lot of things on the table. I said that we could look at a measure of private incentives, the mean. I could look at a measure of the dispersion of private incentives. I could look at a measure of the intensity of complementarity, and those three things will trade off to determine the equilibrium properties of the model. That's exactly what the theoretical models do when they instantiate those ideas into the algebra. But each one of the, but the models all at the end of the day, I don't say all, that is what's going to drive the models. The interplay of heterogeneity, the direction of private incentives, and the strength of social incentives. So I want to make just a couple of comments. The sorts of models that at least I personally work with, they have a property that's sometimes referred to as universality, which and what that means is that in specifying the way that the interaction structures work, there's large classes of them that have the same qualitative properties. It doesn't mean that their properties don't depend on the microstructure. That would be nonsense. But it means that they aren't, that there's a certain robustness to them. So to give an example, suppose I wrote down a model in which you reacted to the people that are kind of, everybody's on a two-dimensional lattice, so you have four nearest neighbors. And I had some idea that if you're, this is the Ising model in physics, that your behavior is sensitive to the four nearest neighbors. And it turned out I got some properties for the environment. If I took the same model and said, oh, I have a revolutionary new idea, it turns out you react to two people on one side. If that model had completely different properties, then we'd be very unhappy because it would say that there's a fragility to the multiple equilibria, the phase transitions, et cetera. And the property of universality is a formalization of the idea that notions such as multiple equilibria, phase transition, they tend to be robust to large classes of perturbations of the structures of social, of interaction. So that's important, you know, that's a virtue because we'll never have enough information on the microstructures of social interactions to be able to privilege one. The second point is these models really are intrinsically, they're deeply nonlinear. And that's an important thing in many senses. I mean, that's where the kind of the interesting theory comes from, the fact they're nonlinear and have unusual properties. It says something about the nature of the econometrics. Not just how you have to estimate them, but all the identification issues are different. For example, the reflection problem doesn't exist in nonlinear models. It doesn't exist in discrete choice models because they are, with the exception of linear probability models, because they are nonlinear. And so it's very important to be sensitive to the nonlinearities. And there's policy implications to that. Okay, so I want to make a few comments about empirical evidence. Some of this will echo previous lectures. And so the way I want to think about empirical evidence on social influences is you know, suppose I was writing the prosecutor's brief. I made a claim. I said social factors are important for understanding contemporary American inequality. What I would want to do if I was going to persuade, I hope, you know, if I need, I don't, I say, when I need to persuade you of this, I'm going to marshal different pieces of evidence. And this is what, the way I want to say this issue of ethnography is underappreciated in economics. The objective is to have the best theory, or what's in philosophy of science called a inference to the best explanation. Okay? And so ethnography, which are detailed descriptions of individual interactions, which have been done in anthropology and sociology, are replete with very powerful evidence and information about social interactions. And so, you know, there's kind of, you know, generations of this. The Elijah Anderson work is now our new classics, or would be Denier and Elijah Anderson. Denier, by the way, was a graduate student in Chicago and wrote about a local diner as his dissertation. And then recent ones are Alice Goffman and Matthew Desmond, whose names have come up. What I want to say, again, this is kind of, you've heard it already, that I think economists are not adequately sensitive to it. And I want to point out one other comment is, I think one of the messages of this is heterogeneity. In other words, that if we're going to model a poverty trap or model a community of profound disadvantage, it's essential to allow for resilience, for heterogeneity, people moving in and out. I think something very deep gets lost when we don't do that. Okay. Second example of evidence are social psychology experiments. And so many of these are classics. Most of the classic ones are illegal now. In other words, they would never pass a review board. I will briefly tell you about what is arguably the most famous one in history, which is the obedience to authority of experiment. Have people heard of that? Okay, so is it okay if I talk about it briefly? Is that? All right, so in the 1950s, Stanley Milgram, a psychologist, wanted to run an experiment to understand the answer to one of the most horrible questions imaginable, which is, why did the Germans do it? This is in the aftermath of the war. The question was, how could this country have engaged in acts of, you know, systematic and very widely participated in genocide? So one of the arguments that was made is that there was something about human nature in which people simply obeyed authority. And so he constructed an experiment for it. And the way the experiment worked, and he did it at Yale in the late 1950s, so you should think of the typical Yale student then as George W. Bush or John Kerry. This is a different generation. They were in the early 60s. It's the same group. So here's the way the experiment worked. You walk into, I've advertised that you're going to be my assistant in a reinforcement learning exercise, and what I need you to do is, he's wired up, and I want to see whether or not I can induce memory through stimulus. So what I do is I ask him a question. He doesn't know the answer, and I tell you to turn this dial up, and he gets a mild electric shock. So now, you remember now? No. So I keep asking you to turn the thing up. At some point, he starts complaining that this really hurts. And I tell you, I'm a doctor. Keep turning it. This is important. So we go on and on. At some point, he will start complaining he has a heart condition. So the question essentially was, what fraction of these privileged children of the sons of the Yale was not co-ed, of the American aristocracy turned the dial to the maximum, despite the fact that the person who was wired up was saying, I have a heart condition? These were not people who had listened to 12 years of Nazi propaganda. These were, as I said, members of the American aristocracy. 70. Okay. So this was considered, you know, a shocking finding. Here's a different form of the experiment, the one that gets a little less publicity. The way it works is, I'm afraid you're the victim again, but I have two collaborators, two insiders. Well, actually, I'm going to have to pick Guiyang, she's my student, right? So the way that it works is, you're wired up, he's wired up, and I need both of you to turn the dials. So the question, and so he goes through the same thing in terms of how he's not doing well. What happens if she refuses? And I tell her, fine, you're fired. You're my new favorite students. Keep turning up the dial. What happened in that environment? 70 went to a very small number. In other words, the second thing that was revealed in the experiment was that the rejection of authority was extraordinarily sensitive to lack of isolation. Okay, so I put this all on the table For two reasons. One is social scientists, these are things you should know. This is part of what social science is. The second thing is to see that that this type of evidence in isolation is extraordinarily powerful. These really are experiments. The difficulty, of course, is the extrapolation into a poverty or inequality-related behavior. But that wasn't what I was doing, was I? I said I'm drawing the prosecutor's brief to put different pieces of evidence on the table so that we want to understand a phenomenon at the end. And so I put the social psychology experiments as objects of interest. There's already been discussion of so-called natural experiments. Natural experiments are usually not natural, but they're somehow, they're events in which there was something differentiates social environments for people in a way where the belief is that you can concentrate on the comparisons of individuals and not worry about the endogeneity of the social structures. Okay, now, in all cases, there'll be some endogeneity of the social structure. The question is whether or not it needs to be accounted for. We've talked about Gautreaux moving opportunity. We've talked about the third is the one I want to talk about. If I asked you the question, what is the one institution in the United States, or let's say, what institution in the United States has the most integrated leadership structure and has, to be blunt, the highest fraction of African Americans who are the bosses of white people? It's actually the U.S. Army. The Army is qualitatively different, which is not to say it's a paradigm. I'd say it's qualitatively different in its organizational structure with reference to integration than other parts of American society. And there is a literature in sociology that is actually simply studying race relations in the Army as distinct from race relations in civilian society. And there are very interesting findings in that literature in terms of what it means for whites and blacks to move through an organization that, first of all, starts with a more integrated structure, and second, has different rules for social interaction. Okay, the background of the, and so this is something, I don't know if the data are available or how to get access to the data, but this is a gold mine of data for social interactions. Because the Army, frankly, doesn't care about race relations or anything else. It cared about one thing, which was warfighting capacity, but it spent unbounded amounts of money studying how the composition of battalions, the structure of affirmative action programs, so on and so forth, would facilitate cohesion. And so I put this on the table, and so I'll give you one example, which is the Army is, there's a debate in affirmative action, which I will get to before the end of this section, about whether to think of affirmative action policies as quote unquote demand side or supply side. So what's that jargon mean? It means that one thing I could do is I could say that the demand side would say that we recognize the test scores, for example, are driven by differences in high school backgrounds, and therefore we don't set just a rule that says this is the test score needed to go to this place. That's what I'm going to call demand side. It alters the rules for the admissions. A different thing I could do, and by the way, I'm not saying it's either or. I want to be clear about that. A different policy would be, I observe the differences that high schools are inducing in test scores, and I implement policies that are targeted to the exact reasons why there's a disparity. So the Army chose the latter course in the issue in trying to address differential promotion rates for non-commissioned officers. And so the background was studying this, what they found, there was a very specific reason for the differential, and that was differences in writing skills, which makes complete sense because black soldiers went to worse high schools than white soldiers. And so the remedy was not to adjust the test scores. What they did is they offered writing classes and set up various mechanisms to engage in what Glenn Lowry's also called this, the supply side affirmative action. And that allows you to study not only kind of what the effects were of supply versus demand side on this particular outcome. You can ask another question. What is the reaction of white soldiers to the programs? Does everyone see the difference? So affirmative action is particularly politically controversial. It creates not defending the reactions, powerful reactions. One can ask the same question: what happened in the Army if you compare these policies? And there's evidence that there were differential effects. So that tells you something about political feasibility. So what I'm saying is simply, this notion of national experiments should not be dismissed. Obviously, there's self-selection to a volunteer army. I'm going to stipulate the sociologists understand it as well as we do. But the point is, that's a sort of data set where you can think, it lets you think creatively about things you might want to identify. Okay. Now here's the final type of evidence. Regressions are friends. And so, this is the typical regression. The thought experiment is, it doesn't matter if it's linear or nonlinear, just the idea is I have data on individuals and I want to explain the heterogeneity in the individuals. And I allow the heterogeneity to have two types of observable explanation. Some are indexed at the individual level, some are indexed at the social level. And so, if I was to predict whether or not I graduate from high school, you'd want to know whether my parents graduated from high school. And to say there is a social influence would be to say it also is on the margin predictive as to whether I grew up in a community with many high school graduates. And so the thought experiment, as I said, is that a statistically significant D is interpreted as evidence, I shouldn't have said neighborhood effect, of a social influence. So that's the cottage industry. I think that if you said to me, I have to give you 700 papers in 2 weeks that find evidence of social interactions, I promise you I could do it. In other words, there is a sea of papers throughout different phenomena finding social interaction effects defined the way I did, which is conditional on individual observable heterogeneity. Is there something about group heterogeneity on the that provides additional explanatory power? I want to make some general comments. Some of them are I think, have not received attention. Other ones, there was a paper here on the exact topic. Just things to think about. The first is just to be aware that this literature, I think, is really underappreciates the measurement problems. And what I mean by that is, if I said to you, neighborhoods matter, okay, that sounds right. Well, how do I measure that? So one paper will have the fraction of families on public assistance. Another one will have the fraction of adults in the community that have white-collar jobs. A third one will have per capita income. The theories of social interactions as they have developed are not rich enough to provide very strong guidance on which empirical measures of neighborhood characteristics ought to be in the regressions. And you can see that creates a very frightening degree of freedom in inferences. Now, there are ways to address that, model averaging and the like, but that has not been systematically investigated in the social interactions literature. I consider that a first order problem. The role of endogenous effects, when I say are typically ignored, I want to be a little careful about that. It is typically, when I say ignored, again, I think that was a sloppy word. It is typically not modeled. That's the better way to say it. In other words, you have many cases where people look for instrumental variables. The philosophy, and that's what the so-called natural experiments are supposed to do. That's really just an instrument. It says that you can find an instrument for the differences in the social structures, the social influences, that when I project it on the instrument, it's uncorrelated with the unobserved heterogeneity. Where there has been relatively little work is on the modeling of the selection process. And so what I want to put here is that is philosophically different, and it has certain important payoffs. So work that Buzz Brock and I have done, we show, for example, that in models of neighborhood effects, it is possible that under random assignment in neighborhoods, identification fails, but under self-selection on unobservables, it holds. Now that sounds weird. Why would that be true? The answer is, well, it occurs at two levels. One of them, but the level that's relevant to us, if I want to understand neighborhood effects, what I want to do, intuitively, what am I doing? I'm taking behaviors and inferring something about what drives them. There is information encoded in the choices of the neighborhoods. There's ways to, if you model the neighborhood formation and the neighborhood choice, that's a richer model. And so that, in other words, all of what I'm saying is there's ways to exploit the additional information. So really what I'm on the table is then thinking about the endogeneity of social structure. If you don't account for it, clearly you're going to get spurious inferences. But if you model it, that should be in statistics is known as model expansion. It is a richer model. There's more information encoded in it about the influences. And so that's why I'm obviously a fan of that approach. Please.
I find it compelling, but in the back of my head, in thinking about this tension, about how models are supposed to be simplifications, right? And how we should try to write the simplest model that we can, and how, you know, kind of advice is not to make it too complicated. And so how do you deal with this trade-off, and like where is the middle ground, and how do you know if you've gone too far or not?
Well, you know, I was actually, and I don't mean to, I know it sounds pretentious. When I said the aesthetic, that matters, that's part of it. That's what I meant. There's a judgment as to the optimal level of complexity. I would say that another way to think about that is that, you know, you sort of ask, what do we use models for? I want to put on the table one of the categories, simply is understanding. I want the model to be simple enough that I can actually understand what it's saying, what the phenomena are that it's embodying. But I want it to be rich enough to embody the set of factors I'm actually thinking about. So in the case of the social interaction, what I'm putting on the table is that if I'm in an environment where I want to know about neighborhood effects and people have moved to the neighborhoods, then I would say that there the trade-off is quote-unquote worth it. That it's a little bit what I said at the beginning, a theory of neighborhood determination of inequality requires both the neighborhoods matter and people have different neighborhoods. And also it's a case where by adding this to, think of it as just adding a second behavior. To say that I look at one behavior and it depends on neighborhoods and there's endogeneity in the neighborhoods, so there was another behavior, it was the neighborhoods. That they together, that's actually the model that one should start by thinking. That, again, but as I said, it's a judgment. There's not going to be an algorithm for that. Please.
I was just going to add that one of the sort of associated issues with not theory variables best capture group effects that we talk about a lot in epidemiology with respect to the measurement issues, what their hypothesis exactly is, and you get these really ill-defined introductions that don't really make a good argument for the sort of right-hand variable you have in your model. So one thing about being more mindful about measurement is also being more clear about what your scientific question precisely
is.
And what about the neighborhood you think is salient with respect.
Yeah, I think that that is a very, very good point. And that's why I think Richard's theory, I keep pointing to her because she has a theoretical model of social learning. And I don't see that well, so being in the second row is a disadvantage. Okay. but the serious point, that's exactly why I think that one of the challenges on the theory side is to move away from what I would call a variables definition of social interactions to a micro, quote, you know, a foundational description of the social interactions. So I think that point's very well taken. And I'll add parenthetically that I think that the economics literature is also not good about, which the epidemiology literature, its bread and butter is dynamics. In other words, the notion that there's transitions in communities, which, you know, we've talked about briefly before, and that actually should be listed here. Final comment I wanted to make is that microstructure, when I say that relatively little is known, I'm making a very specific comment, and that is that the empirical literature typically assumes the microstructure. It says people are in non-overlapping groups, let's say just neighborhoods, and within a neighborhood you react to the average. Or you have a social network and you just react to the average of the people you're connected to. These aren't crazy assumptions, but nevertheless they should be understood as substantive behavioral assumptions. And we don't know much about intensity in particular. So there are three kind of standard econometric criticisms. The first is that I'm going to call the classical identification problem. And that has to do with understanding the distinction between types of social interactions. Some dependencies I can think of, your characteristics affect me, and other ones that your behaviors affect me. That is mathematically equivalent to the classical simultaneous equations problem, when an endogenous variable depends on other endogenous variables and exogenous variables. So what's called the reflection problem in the social interactions literature is the simultaneous equations problem. Okay. The second problem I've already alluded to, which is self-selection, that is how one accounts for the endogeneity of social structure. The third is, I would say is heterogeneity that occurs at a higher than individual level of aggregation. So what I mean by that is that if I'm thinking about the heterogeneity in populations, it may not do to just say each person has an idiosyncratic unobserved characteristic. So let me just talk through briefly an example of those. So suppose that I made the following observation, which is true. okay? And that is that if I look at the poverty rate in a neighborhood, it is associated with the high school dropout rate. They move together. Neighborhoods with high poverty rates have high non-completion rates for high school. So that's the fact. And I want to explain that. Well, you know, here's some ideas. Well, as a social interactions believer, I could say high poverty neighborhoods are responsible for this. In other words, they are a mechanism. I hate the word causality, so I could even, but I'll say it's a cause. So here are the sorts of stories one could tell. All right, and I'm saying no judgment. I'm not saying any of these are empirically meaningful. One of them is I could say it's all self-selection. Okay, this may sound like a political party. I don't mean it to be. And that is that poor neighborhoods are made up of people that just decided they didn't care that much about labor market success. And therefore, people who don't care that much or don't have low aspirations, they transmit it to their children. Their children have low aspirations. And therefore, that explains the high dropout rate. Notice there's nothing social there. It simply says that the process of endogenous neighborhood formation created correlated types in a population. All right, that is consistent with the fact I started with. And remember that the identification problem is not that we have ex ante beliefs about these; it's whether or not the data by itself distinguish them. Okay, that's a theory. Here's one, a different one. People in poor neighborhoods are poor, and I'm not trying to be funny. The point is they can't afford for kids to go to college. Therefore, the incentives for the children to go to college are lower, and therefore they're less likely to graduate from high school. That's self-selection too. But notice that isn't the cultural warrior self-selection. That's the other side of the political spectrum. And so I gave these deliberately and try to be maybe not funny, but provocative. That self-selection works on... doesn't have an ideological flavor. There's no implication as to the efficacy of policy or not. But the point is, again, it's not a social explanation. It's a statement about who's in the neighborhood. Okay, so here's a third example. Teachers aren't as good in high poverty neighborhoods. All right. Superintendents aren't as good. So on and so forth. Is that a social explanation? It is if you think about the political economy. So to play that out a little bit, one reason why teachers in poor neighborhoods are less likely to be good is they don't get paid as much. That says something about the local tax base, the nature of the generation of revenue, or something else about the nature of the way that individual disparities, I'll say in political power, manifest themselves in the organization of a school system. So I want to say that's a type of social interaction, but it seems one that we would think of as having to do with the political structure. Okay. Now here's a different one, which is going to sound a little bit weird, and that is that I could say that a poor neighborhood, one of its characteristics is if there are people that had gone to college in the poor neighborhood, there's a certain sense in which that didn't, because they're poor as well, the college doesn't appear to have paid off very much. And so if you had a bunch of young Bayesians walking around, who didn't know about the Heckman selection correction, this is why, which is really what the theory is saying. If you think about it, what inferences do you think high school students are going to draw about educational attainment and economic success if it happens that the subset of the people that they interact with are not the ones where there were extraordinarily high payoffs? That's very much a William Julius Wilson explanation when he makes arguments about how there were qualitative transformations of inner city black communities with the end of de jure segregation. Okay, it's an informational story. And notice that it's, I can make a joke about them not being good Bayesians, but not knowing the Heckman selection correction. It interacts with something actually that's deeper. And that is, how do individuals form aspirations in the absence of data? What is the meaning of telling somebody who's never seen a doctor with a certain skin color, you can be a doctor if you work hard? That's easy to say it if you have lots of data there. And so this notion of almost of ambiguity in the as opposed to uncertainty, I think, becomes interesting. Please. Exactly. Yes, no, that is very important, and the key is here is that the segregation of the neighborhoods means when anybody started low and did unusually well, that's the truncation in the distribution. And that's what self-selection does exactly. Okay, so that's clearly a social explanation, but it's an information-driven one. Okay, here's a different example. I talked about role models. People, kids react to the distribution of things their parents did, and if it's a community where people don't have a lot, have not graduated from high school, that affects what they do. Yet another explanation would be that they're, okay, so actually I already did this one. So distinguish that from teachers. Here's the final one I wanted, which is there may be some conformity effects going on. And so what happens is if there's some differential in family investment because of inequality, early childhood, that interacts with the peer effects, and that could create substantial disparities in adolescence. My point's the following, that all seven of those explanations create a correlation between the poverty rate and the high school non-completion rate. And if you think about them, the first two explanations are statements that there is nothing social going on. Rather, entirely the endogeneity of neighborhoods creates a spurious relationship. The third explanation was an unobserved group level effect. In other words, it said that if you look at these communities, this one had good teachers, this one didn't, for whatever reason. Explanations 4, 5, and 6 are examples of what are called contextual effects. It said there was something about the distribution of adults that was influencing the outcomes of the children. And then the final one was an example which made an argument that the social structure between children itself was explaining some of the disparities, and that's what's called an endogenous effect. And so this really is kind of the topology of the identification problems. So if you ask what I think, that's why I said I was going to give you the prosecutor's brief. Obviously, I think that social interactions are first order, that these social determinants in many dimensions are quite significant. I want to be honest. I think that most of the statistical, if I said which one is the weakest, it's probably the statistical literature because of the many problems that we face in terms of the gap between the theoretical conception, the quality of the data, and the empirical instantiation. It's not to say it's worthless or that there isn't evidence there, but that's probably the case that that we need to worry about the most. And I think that that the identification problems are not fully appreciated. Okay, so the last couple of things I wanted to say in this part of the lectures is just a few two comments about policy. The first is that I think that focusing on the social determinants of inequality entails a way to think about redistributive policies, distributive justice, and what I've called it in my own work is associational redistribution, which I know is an ugly name, but what I'm trying to say is that conventional redistribution policies, you have a distribution of income and you move it around. That's what taxes and transfers are supposed to do. But a different thing we could do is try to influence the associations people have. If we think that social structure matters, that is itself a policy variable, or at least dimensions of it are a policy variable. These are not weird things in any way. These are standard policies. And so I will put on the table just three educational examples. Affirmative action policies, in my mind, are just simply choices of assignment rules that say that we have some vision of the objectives of higher education. We choose the assignment rules in response to that. If somebody says that they talks about affirmative action, I think all they're saying is that here is a baseline that has been given for assignment rules, and we're thinking about deviations from the baseline. Okay, and that's all that, there's nothing deeper than affirmative action than that. The idea that there's something weird about it, I think, it's simply asking about this, asking about questions about the composition of student bodies in education. Another example, this was done, was quite extensive in the United States, and for reasons I don't understand, there are very few studies of the effects, because I assume the data are still around, which was busing to achieve integration in schools. So in the history of the U.S., there was a sequence of court decisions and legislation powerful public movements that diminished legal de jure segregation of school districts, there was nevertheless obviously enormous segregation of neighborhood schools because of location. And so there was a sequence of court decisions in the 60s and 70s and a little bit in the 80s, which in essence said that if there was an affirmative obligation on the part of school districts to integrate schools. And so there are many programs are set up to integrate schools within school districts. And those programs have largely disappeared, but they existed for a number of years. And they are, again, an example in which the government made an explicit policy choice. A very different form of a contemporary policy choice, which would affect the location of students in different classrooms and schools, are charter and magnet schools. Okay, all I want on the table is that we can think about these in terms of having some vision as to how we want the social structure to look. Okay. I have a paper called Affirmative Action and Meritocracy, which discusses whether or not the relationship between meritocracy and affirmative action, and actually argues that that the conventional rules about you have to have a minimum test score are not meritocratic, and that's a misunderstanding. So I will urge you to read that if the philosophical issues interest you. But what I want on the table is that each one of the, all we have is a universe of candidate rules for college admissions. I could have random admissions. I could have admissions based on location, on local admissions the same way I have them for high schools. I could have sophisticated admissions that say I admit people where the value added to college is highest. That's not the same as the highest test scores, is it? And so if you think about it from that perspective, all I want on the table is if composition matters, we want to think about composition in different spheres. Now, if one asks about distributive justice, which at the end of the day, you know, these are deep normative issues, you know, I think one wants to recognize that ways one would make the arguments here. And what I want to put on the table, and this is something you should be aware of, is that there have been important contributions by economists to political philosophy, specifically on the issue of distributive justice. And so the most important writer, in my judgment, is actually the two key writers are Amartya Sen and John Romer. And I want to talk about Romer's ideas. Romer has this idea that inequality is justified if people can be held responsible for it. So the example would be if you and I go to a casino and I win and you lose, I don't have to give you half of my winnings because we both made a choice. We are meaningfully responsible for it. So in the Romer world, then the political question is, how do we think about sources of inequality for which individuals are not legitimately held responsible, and then think about policies that would address that? Now, the reason I use the word political is, it's at some level, I could say everything is deterministic. Laplace's demon means that nothing is held responsible. We don't want to end up with that type of nihilism. Rather, we want to ask the more grounded political question, can we think about different mechanisms for inequality where the responsibility notion becomes particularly problematic? And neighborhoods are clearly an example of that. Assignment to elementary schools are clearly examples of that. And so, again, in my own writings, I've elaborated why these seem to be particularly compelling examples of where the Romer arguments would be powerful. And I've even argued that they are stronger than the direct input of parents into children. What I really want on the table is not the defensive school, that the really invidious ones are social, but rather that this responsibility metric becomes essential. Now, in thinking about normative issues, the main thing is just to be aware that obviously there's going to be competing ethical claims. And the only comments I wanted to make there are twofold. In going through arguments on ethical claims, really, I think that the way that we want to think about policies like affirmative actions, we put on the table these notions of responsibility. But there's two other notions we have to think about. One of them is desert. In other words, we have a notion that people deserve certain things. So we wouldn't say, for example, it would be hard to make a principled argument that I deserve an Olympic gold medal in the pole vault. And I can assure you, there was no state of the universe where I could ever have earned it. No effort was going to get it, because the point is I've defined a context in which our ethical intuitions talk about desert. All right. And so I put that on the table, as I want you to notice when I said something's particularly ethically salient about neighborhoods. It's because it's very hard to make an argument, I deserve to be in a high school that has certain, you know, that has a swimming pool and a, you know, a district level poet that invites students. I'm describing Beverly Hills, so forth. This is where it's a little bit trickier to talk about parents. Because I could say nobody deserves to have parents that care about them more than others. But what about the parents? Don't I deserve to be able to do extra things for my kids? That's where you get into trickier things about direct, everything about parents, some of that we think of as having a domain that warrants respect. And the other thing is we do think about kind of self-actualization, that we want people to be able to fulfill their lives in the ways that they define, and that often will entail, when you let people do that, creating inequalities. And that's a little bit the flip side. If I want to read 2 hours a night to my kids, because that's what defines my life, to have a policy that made the marginal value of that zero, that's interfering with the self-actualization. None of this is to say, I think you probably already know where my political my views are on these policies. That's not the point. The point is to think through the ethics. You need to put responsibility, desert, and self-actualization, in my judgment, on the table and think through any implied trade-offs between them. Final comment I want to make about policy is this nonlinearity business. And that is, I want to at least just put a question on the table. Suppose I have a fixed amount of money, okay? And here's what I can do. I can go to, I'm from LA, or from the LA area, so I'm gonna take the LA school district, and I can offer every student in the LA system a certain scholarship value if they graduate from college. Or I can pick one high school and offer them full college scholarships. If you take the nonlinearity social interaction perspective, the bang for buck might be substantially higher if I take a subset of the schools and target all the resources. On the other hand, in doing that, that creates what would be a prima facie unfairness because there was nothing special about those schools. So all I want to put on the table is that in thinking about equity and efficiency trade-offs and the like, nonlinearity is extremely important, and we want to be sensitive to its presence. Okay, so that was my 10. That's my 90 minutes. And when we get back, I want to talk about a little bit more algebra and complementarity, a little algebra and sort of matching, and then I want to give you a model. Okay. Okay. So what I'd like to do in this half there are four sets of lecture notes that were distributed. The second one's called theory, and it has four pieces. I'm only going to talk about the first two. The third piece is. It's called statistical mechanics or random fields. It's just about some mathematics that's useful in modeling interaction populations. It is very heavy on definitions and heuristics, and there's some indication of where proofs are. And then the final part is goes through a model that Buzz Brock and I developed, which shows you how you would formally model the trade-off between private incentives, heterogeneity, complementarity, and get properties such as phase transitions and multiple equilibria. What I want to do in the lecture instead is get the two key intuitions on the table and do that with very elementary models. The first, as I said, is going to be basically this idea of complementarity and why it is so powerful in driving results. And what I want to do is I'm going to teach a classic paper due to Russ Cooper and Andrew John, which was developed in a macro context, and nevertheless, it's going to illustrate an extremely important idea, and it does it in the cleanest possible way. This is an example, by the way, from the perspective of theory as models as understanding. And what I mean by that is this is not a model we would ever, it's a model about macro phenomena to understand how you get persistent low output, et cetera, but it's not a model one would ever take the data. It's far too abstracted for that. Its point was to facilitate thinking and understanding something. So this model, the way it's going to be set up is that there's going to be a population. Everybody interacts with everybody else. There's going to be a simple social structure. And each person, the way I'm going to set it up, makes a choice in an interval 0 to 1. And that's just effort. So it's literally this thing about how hard we're going to work on a project or something like that. And so the preferences are going to be very, very simple. And that is that the payoff to me depends on how hard I work and how hard everybody else works. Okay, notice that is a very powerful implied assumption about social structure. It says that everybody affects me equally. In fact, your identities are irrelevant. I could permute you and get exactly the same answer. All right? I'm going to assume this function is twice differentiable. If you look at the modern theory of complementarity, a la Milgram and Roberts, much of it has to do with relaxing the requirements of the smoothness on preference functions and talking about much more elaborate supports for the choices, et cetera. We're interested here in complementarity and equilibria, so again, we want this to be to avoid mathematical generality in order for clarification. So we're going to have twice differentiability. Furthermore, whenever I give a first order condition, I'm not going to say, well, maybe it was an inequality, maybe it's an equality. No, I'm always going to assume there's an interior solution. Right. So the simplest, and so the key to the paper is going to be one behavioral assumption, one substantive assumption, and that is the cross partial of that function. And that is that the cross partial is positive. That is the definition of a complementarity here. Now, what does it mean to say a cross partial is positive? Well, it means the derivative of a derivative is positive. So what's key is the derivative of my payoff with respect to my own effort is increasing in the effort of others. That's what it means for the cross partial to be positive. And that is the key idea of complementarity. What is it I do as a non-cooperative agent or as an individual maximizer? I set marginal cost to the marginal payoff to zero. Implicit in that, because it's the net cost, is the benefit and the cost or marginal cost are equated, so the net goes to zero. The key of the cross partial being positive says that for every level of effort, the marginal for me is higher when others are doing a lot. And that's going to drive the whole model. Now notice something. If I take that cross partial and I integrate it between values BA and DC, I'm going to get this calculation. What is this? That's the difference between my payoff at high effort versus lower effort when others are making a high effort choice. What is this? That's the difference between my payoff at high effort versus low effort when others are making a low effort choice. Well, if I take a positive function, I integrate it over it, I get a positive number, right? I'm just looking at rectangles under positive stuff. So I know that to say there's complementarity says that that difference is positive. That's what controls behavior. I'm comparing more or less effort when others are high versus others are low. If that's positive, it says that there's an incentive for me to do more when others are doing more. We're going to see that calculation, that particular comparison again. So, the key idea is that when we get objects like that, because I just rewrote it that way, is that at the end of the day, complementarities induce correlative behavior. Others do more, my incentives to do more are increased. So, the model will have, if I fully described the model, I've described individual behavior. People make choice, or characterize individual payoffs. All I want on the table is this fundamental idea. Complementarity says, others do more, I do more. And so what then Cooper and John do is they basically characterize the equilibrium of the model. But to do that, I have to have a rule for the adjudication of the interdependences. And so a Nash equilibrium idea would simply say that each person optimizes taking as given the choices of others. This is where the assumption that everybody's the same and everything's symmetric makes life easy for us. Because if everybody's the same, I can focus on symmetric equilibria, i.e. everybody makes the same choice. And so the choices, well, that's a terrible thing to have done to me. The characterization of a non-cooperative equilibrium says everybody makes the same choice, and at that common choice, everybody's happy they did it. That was the right thing to do. So I have a trivial description of the non-cooperative equilibrium. The cooperative equilibrium, in contrast, is this. Because if we were to sit in a room, incredibly contract, to make a joint effort level, again, we'd all do the same thing, but I'd maximize the overall function. The trick is, everybody would work so that the marginal payoff of their own effort is negative because they're compensated by the extra effort of everybody else. So I would have an incentive to shirk. I would love for all of you to work really, really hard, and I would do less. But that's what it means to say it's a cooperative equilibrium. We have contracted, so to speak, or we can credibly agree to these higher effort levels. Please. Yes, yes, the appeal to me of speaking a certain way would go down if certain others do the same thing. That would be the equivalent here. So what I want on the table, in other words, is this very, again, this is what the beauty of the model is. It was as simple can be, but it clarified idea number one, complementarity, as being fundamental. Now notice, this is what made it a macro paper, is that that there's more activity here versus here, and so we saw that without some coordination of behaviors, we got something that was socially inefficient. For our purposes, what we're going to care about is the following, and that is there chalk here? Yes. I can think about the 45 degree line, and what would a non-cooperative equilibrium be? In a non-cooperative world, if you tell me what others are doing, I know what I'm going to do, right? So that's called the best response function. Because it's complementary, I already showed you what? It's an increasing function. So therefore, that's a candidate for phi, and in that case, that's the equilibrium. What's the difference between that case and this case? Here, that upward sloping function only intersects at one point, right? Here it intersects at three places. That's the example of unique equilibrium in the presence of complementarity. And what is this? Multiple equilibria in the presence of complementarity. Now, we could go through a more sophisticated analysis to ask, well, are these equilibria stable when we set up dynamics, et cetera? For what it's worth, those are the two we would focus on, because the interior one is not stable under usual ways we talk about dynamics. But what I want you to see is a couple of things. Number one, complementarity gave us this increasing best response function. That's a key idea. And so, as Cooper and John, as the theorem in their paper says, complementarity is necessary for multiple equilibria, because if the thing was always downward sloping, once it hit, it could never get back up there. But point two, and this is what I emphasized in the first lecture, complementarity is not sufficient. And what's going to be key is that the complementarity can be strong enough. And so intuitively, the complementarity is the slope of this. Here it's a nice gentle slope, less than one. So we still get uniqueness. What mattered here is that the slope was greater than one, therefore a range of strong complementarity was required to create the multiplicity. Please. That's a great question, time, because I was not careful about time. The assumption was I see everybody, but I don't talk to them. So that it was I know what everybody's doing, and I made a response that was optimal given that. I could set up a dynamic analog to this, which could say I look at what you did last period, and then I make a choice today. And what would happen is that the would have certain stable limits, but their time isn't really respected here. Please. Yes. Yes. No, thank you. And that's important clarification. Everybody knows that everybody's rational, and so that basically they've all worked through the implications of the model. Thank you. Okay. So that's it. Those are for us the key. So why did I make a big deal about this? Because this clarified an exact result, which was in this environment, complementarity is necessary for multiple equilibria. Strong complementarity can produce multiple equilibria. And we can get very clean comparisons of cooperative versus non-cooperative equilibria. Notice that in this model, the cooperative equilibrium is efficient. if I wasn't, and I'm thinking about micro context, that's very interesting to us, because it says that when people are making investment decisions with complementarity, we would expect some social inefficiency, because they aren't nobody is internalizing the spillover effects. So people do not, you know, I'm focusing on my favorite whipping children, which are the teenagers who are not saying, well, if I smoke, you know, there's going to be a peer effect on others, etc. Not all that's ruled out. Okay. Notice as well, let me not make that second comment. I just want on the table the notion that this uninternalized spillover effect has important social consequences. So if I was going to sort of tell a story, political discussions about poverty tend to be, I want to caricature both sides. So one side, quote unquote, would say, well, if we see a very disadvantaged community, we could think of the community as here. They're in this trap in which individuals are making choices that are reinforcing, but they're kind of socially undesirable. That's kind of a story you see sometimes, that some, you know, these cultural explanations often come down to that. Everyone with me? A different story would be one that said that a community has low outcomes because it's simply there are no opportunities. It's ridiculous to talk about people having high wages if there aren't good jobs. It's ridiculous to talk about the marriage market when people are incarcerated, so on and so forth. The question I want to ask is, from the vantage point of this very small model, are those different? How do those explanations interact? All right, so what do I mean by that? Suppose I write down a model with social interactions in it, and lo and behold, it has three equilibria this way. And somebody says to me, I think this is the equilibrium for a disadvantaged community. Does that entail anything about the role of opportunities? No. And this is the point I want you to see. Suppose that I were to pass a program that increased the private incentives for E. What would that mean? It would mean moving this curve up. It would mean that at every level of the social influence, people would do more of something. Everybody with me? Well, what happens if I move it here? The equilibrium becomes unique again. And so my point's the following, that any social explanation which says this is a poverty trap, says that there's some other configuration that could have been better, a condition for that implicitly was that the economic fundamentals weren't strong enough. You need weak economic fundamentals in this model in order for the social influences to create the multiplicity. And so the message I want on the table is not that these are opposing ideas, that it's opportunities versus cultural, and I'm making fun of the political thing, a serious thing here, social versus private. It's their interplay that determines the outcomes. And so if one is worried that communities can be, or subpopulations can become associated with these traps, so to speak, an answer always is improve opportunities, because the possibility of a stable trap presupposes an absence of opportunity. And so my point is not actually to say something non-political, which is you can't distinguish private and social incentives as competing explanations. They interact in complicated ways, and that will tell you how to do the cost-benefit calculations and think about the determination. Okay, everybody okay with that? All right, that's all I want to say about Cooper-John. But what I do want to talk about now is a sort of matching, and I'm going to do it in the context of the classic Gary Becker model of marriage. All right. Now, one thing to think about is that a special case of the Cooper-John model is, what if there's only one other person? So I could have had a model in which there was a population of two, and so each person just reacted to the other. And that's a little bit in the spirit of a marriage model, except there's going to be a lot of people called M's, and a lot of people called W's, and they're going to form lots of coalitions, pairings, of one M and one W. But then something could happen within the M and the W pairing. So the way the Becker marriage model is going to work is that I'm going to have N men and women. So this is, and so that everybody's going to be matched in the model. And it's a very romantic model. So what happens is the purpose of the match is to produce something. So this is going to be phi, so that the M has a quality, the W has a quality. They go into the production function and produce something. We'll talk about what that thing is in a moment. It's the matching, that function is increasing in both arguments. In other words, there's an implicit in this idea that there's a scale of quality for the M's and the W's, a scalar, and every is a complete ordering. Okay, and so it increases. So here's a question. Suppose I were a social planner, and what I want to do is I want to maximize the sum of the products of the marriages. Everybody with me? How would I match people up? One possibility is to take the highest M and the highest W. That's marriage number one. Second highest M, second highest W, marriage number two. That's what a sort of mating is called, or I just want to see a sort of matching. Another possibility is I would take the highest W and match her with the lowest M. The second highest W, second lowest M, that would be negative assorted matching. Okay, so there's, in other words, you can think of all these different configurations I can set up for the marriages, and I just want to maximize the total product. It's the same thing as maximizing the average product. So what Becker showed was that if the inputs of the two people in the two members of the marriage are complements, then a sort of matching maximizes the sum. That's the classic assortative matching complementarity relationship. Now, I claim we already proved that. If it's the case that assortative matching is efficient, then it has to be the case if I took that there's no, it would be impossible to have an assortively matched pair, two highs, two lows, and then mix them and get more. Well, I already did that calculation when I did it for the Cooper-John model. In other words, the fact that the cross-partial is positive in the marital function says that when I do that comparison, I will always get it efficient to assortively match. Everybody with me on that? So that becomes the second key idea, that there's something about complementarity and assortative matching that links things up. And that was what I meant when I said that if there are these social influences, we're going to be interested in their consequences for social structure, and it turns out the same thing, complementarity, which drives multiple equilibria, or the social multipliers, also drives the incentives for segregation. Okay. Now, one comment you could make is, I didn't actually talk about the marriage market, did I? I said the social planner. And so a distinction one wants to draw is between the notion of efficiency I put on the table and what would actually happen when individuals were forming marriages. So let's think about that a little bit. And let's consider the following. This is the way to make this very concrete. I don't want to talk about bargaining. Let's just suppose that the marital production function, the way is divisible. Whatever it is, I'm not Solomon. It's not a baby right now. All right, it just produces something and it's going to be divided up. And it turns out that the marital production function exhibits constant returns to scale. Everyone with me? So what do we know from that model? If everybody's paid his or her marginal product to their quality, that will exhaust the marital output, and that's the market equilibrium. So we're done. So in other words, in the constant returns to scale case, I could metaphorically, literally think of a market in which the skill I bring as a M or as a W is this thing I was calling the scalar, and everybody gets paid their marginal product. That exhausts things, and that's the market equilibrium. And this is what, when Larry Bloom was talking about transferable utility, we were saying, well, let's suppose that the thing that the marriage produces is not directly divisible. It could be treated as if it's divisible if there's this additive utility component which allows for the partners to engage in transfers to each other. And so what I want on the table, in other words, is that by starting with the social planner's problem, one can then argue conditions under which that is the equilibrium in which individuals simply form marriages, and the condition for the equilibrium is the so-called, is a stability one that no pair of people wishes to withdraw from their current marriages and form a new one. All right. Now, I want to think about the implication. Is everybody with me? So there's a very simple model. I guess you make this, whatever this thing is that marriages produce, the cross-partial is positive. It turns out that's what people will choose as their marriages. It's also what would maximize some notion of total marital output. Okay. So here's my question. If I were, now, I'm the new social planners come in and I no longer care about efficiency as in maximizing the total output, I'm an egalitarian. Of all the configurations of marriages, which configuration maximizes the inequality between the highest and lowest output marriages? Of any possible configuration. Under complementarity, the equilibrium one. Okay. So again, very simple model. Now, something I actually think is a very important, profound idea, which is this is a real equity efficiency trade-off. It says it's fundamental to thinking about what a market would look like. And notice, suppose I didn't call this a marriage model. I called it a model of employment in which a firm is made up of a manager and a worker. Another M&W. We'd have exactly the same outcomes, wouldn't we? And so, in fact, the model will generalize if there's more than two types. I could have, you know, firms with 75 people, so on and so forth. You keep getting the same results. That's part of the Becker's genius, was the simple model turns out to have all these dimensions where these are very sturdy outcomes. What I want you to see is that the market equilibrium here simultaneously is inequality maximizing. And so that, to me, is a very interesting way to understand equity efficiency trade-offs, which is in the presence of complementarity, there are these mechanisms that induce sorting. And as a result, we have a way of configuring individuals where we see very high levels of inequality.
What does CRS buy you?
It let me think about prices easily. So I could say that the factor price for the male quality and the factor price of the female quality exhausted the product. That was all.
Okay.
Okay, so now so that's idea one on the table now, which is and this is, remember, the second idea that I wish to as it were, push, which is that when we think about complementarity, it says something about how we would expect social structures to evolve. Please. Oh, so let me say two things. One, I don't know that it is. The theorem is if there's complementarity, then a sort of matching is both would be the equilibrium outcome. Okay. What the proof would say, I just said think CRS, because then it was easy to see that if people are walking around with different values of this input and everybody gets paid marginal product, then what the matching has to do is it just sets the prices equal to marginal product, and then that exhausts the product and we're done. In a more sophisticated model where you would need the transferable utility, and that's where a little bit of elbow grease is needed just to show that's also the equilibrium. But it's if complementarity is there. Okay. And as I said, but think about, okay, I was making jokes about it being marriage. That doesn't have to be. I could have been a firm where I'm thinking about workers of different types. And so what you see here is, in other words, incentives for a sort of matching of skill types. So if somebody asks the question, as you may know, if you go to a management consulting firm in New York City, you will meet the most, let's say, unless you're working with here, the staff is unbelievably productive. I mean, and they get paid extremely high salaries, and it's because there's a sort of matching of skill types in different categories. So that's really what I want on the table. It's kind of a very general idea. So in the lecture notes, they work through lots of generalizations, such as what happens if each of the firms is of size K versus size 2, or the marriages are of size K. None of that, all of the Becker results go through. There is one dimension in the lecture notes where they don't go through, and that is if firms can be different sizes. Essentially, suppose that the way the world works is there's firms of size 1, marriages of size 1, size 2, and size 3. Then even though each of the sizes may have internal complementarity, there's no guarantee you would assortatively match. Metaphorically, you might take the high quality one type and put them with 500 low types, and because of the fact that you have different scales. But all I want on the table, and just read through the notes on the details, is that there's a very robust idea there, and that is the relationship between complementarity and incentives for segregation. Okay. So I want to end this discussion with just another question to put on the table. Is everybody with me? All I want to say, here's the simplest model imaginable. I want CRS, so we can just think of it as a market for these inputs. The equilibrium outcome is the social planner's outcome to maximize the average, and it's the inequality maximizing one. And we have this idea complementarity gets linked to segregation. Here's a question I want to put on the table. Suppose that I came in and I announced, I actually find this idea of marital bargaining, it's yuck. So I'm passing a law. Everybody with me? Oh, by the way, I don't want firms to pay people differentially either. I'm going to pass a law that says that the way a firm or a marriage is organized is every member of the organization must share equally. Everybody with me? Okay. I'm going to eliminate differential payments within organizations. The question I put to you is, what would that do to inequality? You have to think about it at two steps. Given who is in what marriage, and given or who is at what firm, if I pass a law of equal compensation, that reduces inequality. Because either, think about it, because it can't change the output across the units, but it's going to equalize it within the units. So that's clearly an egalitarian enhancing policy. But that isn't the whole story, is it? The problem is I have to ask the second question. How does the equal sharing rule affect the equilibrium allocation of partners across marriages or workers across firms? So let's think about that one. Everybody with me? I went through this big deal. I said, complementarity implies the efficiency of a sort of matching. It implies a sort of matching is the market outcome. What if there isn't complementarity? What if the cross-partial is negative? What's the efficient outcome then, and the market outcome? Highest W, lowest M. Second highest W, second lowest M, so on and so forth. In other words, in the presence of substitutability, we know the efficient market equal integration. So let's suppose I'm in that world. Well, actually, so keep in mind there's really two worlds I want to think about, complementarity, substitutability. If the world is made up of complementary, the question I put to you is, would anything happen with respect to the configuration of the marriages? If I said there's equal sharing and there's complementarity, would the marriages change? The answer is no. The highest M and the highest W still would form the biggest marriage because they produce the most together. It's just they can't have a differential sharing of the output. So if there's complementarity, then the equal sharing rule would be equality enhancing in the sense it would reduce within marriage inequality. What about the substitutability case? If I ruled out unequal compensation, then the equilibrium in the marriage market would once again be highest M, highest W. Because if they can't, if people with different locations in the rank can't have unequal sharing, there's no incentive for somebody to have a partner who isn't as high as possible. The reason under substitutability, under the substitutability assumption that the highest W took the lowest M is because she got most of the payoff. But if I say it's 50-50, there's no incentive to do that anymore. So in fact, in this very simple model, we get a perverse result, which is I pass a rule that says there's equal sharing in every organization, and it increases inequality because it altered who interacts with who. Okay, and so it's a toy example, but there's a message there. And that is when we think about policies that are designed for the enhancement of, have distributive justice objectives with respect to equality, we can, in these social environments, we have to work out the equilibrium consequences of the new rules on who's where. So let me be politically, I want to talk about a political question. Okay, there's a lot of discussion about free college. And so one flavor of it is an example, which is discussed at Wisconsin, is there should be no merit scholarships. Those should be abolished. Another argument is that colleges should, that there should be some mechanism that sets the tuition at public universities to zero. Okay, and the arguments that are made, and they're made in good faith, obviously, are egalitarian arguments. Why would I bring that up in the context of the toy example? Because it tells us there is something that people don't know the answer to. and haven't really, to be blunt, the policy discussion has not thought through. And that is, what is the consequence of altering tuitions to zero for the equilibrium configurations of students across colleges? Okay. Now consider, just again, I'm making no empirical claim. This is just saying, well, if you think about it as a matter of theory, here's some things one would be concerned about. One of them is quite natural, which is, in isolation, if I were to make the University of Wisconsin the tuition zero, one of the things I might think is that more affluent parents would put pressure on their kids to go to Wisconsin, because now it's, the price is lower versus whatever private schools there's going to. So in other words, the private schools are still not zero. There may be a shift in who applies to the college. And remember, the way that I said that was affluent parents. In other words, what I was saying was kids who had access to better high schools. So you could imagine that the competition for the slots at a public university might disadvantage the disadvantaged, comparatively speaking, because you're adding in a bunch of people from other high schools. So it may say, so at a minimum, the policy, if it's supposed to be egalitarian, may have to think about, says, may have to have a form of affirmative action associated with it, which is, I didn't refer to ethnicity here, gender, or whatever, I'm referring to socioeconomic background, because in isolation, if you start changing the incentives of advantaged people to apply to UW, well, then that's going to have some effect if there's a fixed number of slots. So that would be one example. Here's a different example. Proposals have been made that the way to finance the zero tuition is to abolish all government support for loans for private schools. So the idea is that if you want to, that things like all the federal programs are eliminated if the money's going to be used for private schools. If you think about that policy, what would that do in terms of places like the University of Chicago? Pardon me? Well, it would make it more difficult, and so what you could end up there is, within public universities, certain effects for positive, desirable effects for the disadvantaged, but it may actually increase segregation across universities of different types. And so again, I honestly am not trying to take a stance on the desirability of the proposal so much, is to just say that one of the reasons for doing theory with these admittedly elementary models is I think they sensitize to thinking about general equilibrium effects for policies that with particular intents. And so, at a minimum, what I want you to see here is that if you, in some sense, interfered with the market, which would be setting the prices in the marriage model or the firm model, one could have inegalitarian results from what appeared to be an egalitarian policy. And I do want to mention that. There's a paper by Gall, LaGrosse, and Newman, which works this out in great detail and shows how, in various circumstances, one gets excess segregation, socially efficient segregation, when you rule out the scope for differential returns on things. That's really a very nice paper. All right, so as I said, that's really all I wanted to say about theory. So I want those two ideas on the table, as well as kind of implicit in that, as well as the recognition that we do have to work through the equilibrium effects, because you can get unintuitive results otherwise. So any questions on complementarity and multiple equilibria, that nexus, the complementarity and segregation nexus? Please. Oh, in the models I work with, everybody is rational in the sense that they are thinking through the equilibrium consequences.
Right, because I was thinking of it, in this model of firms, for example, multi-classes. So maybe something of where you can hire the highest qualified individual if you have the best firm. But then after that happens, after we have a complete segregation, then the high skilled individuals will pay a very high compensation because they're not going to have a highest firm. And that's something that the firm might not like, to have a situation where there is complete segregation, because then they have to pay a much higher salary for the high-skilled workers, and they kind of take into consideration the possibility of a more homogeneous distribution.
Okay, so what I would argue is that the following, the segregation is not desired or undesired, or just the equilibrium setting of the wages or the returns, the factors in the marriage, mean that at the equilibrium there will be segregation. The way it would work is any initial configuration, if I'm not segregated, the firm that has the highest worker of one type will bid up the price that the worker of the highest other type gets until they move there. Now, you might think, but so that's comment number one. Comment number two is, because the market is frictionless, that was another reason I like sort of saying constant returns of scale, marginal product factor pricing. You maybe say that the firm is concerned about market power developing. So to play this out, I could imagine an environment in which I hire two people, and what happens in the course of being at the firm is you develop firm-specific human capital and extra general human capital. That could give the workers bargaining power. But that's a very different environment than the one that I set up. And so I think that you could make arguments about incentives for heterogeneous workforces, but those would require different types of production functions. And if you worked it out, it would actually imply that the production functions did not exhibit the strict complementarities I've talked about, or at least, better said, the profit functions wouldn't. That, pardon me? Oh yes, there's no logical requirement that our egalitarian or equality notions have to be violated. What I wanted was to say, in this universe, this toy universe under these assumptions, which are intuitive or interpretable assumptions, then we get this trade-off between them. And the intuition on the interpretable assumption, when I say it's interpretable, is I'm really just saying this. Complementarity says that if somebody is very talented, that matching with another very talented person creates an enormous amount. So that somehow that's the synergy that exists. And so what we want to be aware of is that when those synergies exist in production functions and neighborhood effects, what have you, that implies that we would expect that the decentralized environments in which people are matching and the like can produce levels of segregation which are associated with high levels of inequality. And they are efficient by kind of conventional metrics. And so, but I'm not making a claim either that that's the universally how the world works, but it's really an insight into how to think about environments in the real world. All right, so what I want to do to finish up is I want to take some of the ideas I put on the table, kind of the general memberships ideas, as well as the interplay of notions of complementarity or notions of social influences and segregation, and link them up to discuss something. And so what I'm going to do is talk about what I'm going to call the micro foundations of the Great Gatsby curve. I guess the first question is what, and this is with my colleague Ananth Seshadri, and let me explain first of all what the Great Gatsby curve is, and then proceed. So the Great Gatsby curve is based on the following observation. Miles Corak, an economist at University of Ottawa, produced a figure that's got an enormous amount of attention both in academia and in the policy world, and was named by the then chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, Alan Krueger, the Great Gatsby curve. What the curve is the following, and that is, it looked at the OECD and it basically asked the following question. I'm going to draw the curve a little differently than it's conventionally presented. What it did was it asked the question, suppose you take a country like Denmark, and there are statistics to measure both mobility and inequality. An example would be the Gini coefficient of wages could measure inequality within cross-sectionally or across life courses, depending on how you do it. And then I could have a measure, let's say, of the correlation of offspring income and parental income. Could do that for the United States, could do it for Norway, do it for France, Italy, the United States, blah, blah, blah. And the observation, roughly speaking, was that there were some countries that were here low inequality, high mobility, and there were some other countries here. And what appeared to be true for the OECD was that countries that had low cross-sectional inequality also had high mobility. Now, those of you that have seen the curve before see it goes like this, but that's because they didn't put mobility, they put persistence, the negative, the opposite, one divided by mobility. And so what turned out was here was like Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and here the Anglophone Empire once again. Okay, so the serious point is that what the data suggested was if you looked across the OECD, the countries that had lower inequality cross-sectionally also had lower correlation of parents and offspring, whereas the countries which had high inequality had higher correlation. Why would this be such a big deal politically? It's because, you know, the way that discussions of inequality often occur in politics, particularly in the United States, is that Americans are concerned about equality of opportunity as opposed to equality of outcomes. And one would intuitively think of mobility as a measure of the equality of opportunity. And so the fact that the higher cross-sectional inequality isn't associated with high mobility is where the action came, so to speak, from that. All right, everybody with me? That's just a stylized fact. As I said, due to Miles Corak, it should be called the Corak curve, but unfortunately for him, for better or worse, it's now known as the Gatsby curve. All right. So that's the fact to it, please.
So with mobility, like, is it only time off upward, or?
Okay, now you've asked a great question, which is what do we mean by mobility?
It's like if everything's on distribution, then you always have, like, something goes up.
Oh, that's relative.
There, you know.
Yours is relative. This was for absolute. I look at the correlation of parents and children.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, by itself, I actually don't, you know, there's questions as to how to interpret this curve. If I, you know, so as I like to repeat myself, at one conference where it was presented, I raised my hand and said the problem with looking at Norway and comparing it to the United States is Norway's filled with Norwegians. Okay. The serious point is if you take this huge heterogeneous society and compare it to an extremely homogeneous society, it's not clear what message I receive from that. And if I wanted to be, you know, a little more provocative, if I asked the question about assimilation of immigrants, do you really think the United States looks uniquely bad compared to continental Europe? It's not so obvious, is it? My point is that, as you say, it's very difficult to think about mobility. I am uncomfortable because of the degree of heterogeneity across the units and looking at these really structurally different societies. What I do want to say is that there's also limited evidence, so this is controversial, of a Gatsby curve within a country, which would be a way of saying that it appears that when inequality increases, there's some diminution of mobility rates. And that's what this model is going to be about. Not a international Gatsby curve, but the possibility of an intertemporal Gatsby curve within a given country. And so in some sense, I've already given away the story, because what it's going to do is it's going to be a model that formalizes what would be the memberships theory, in the sense that what's going to happen in the model is that there's going to be social structures forming. Those social structures influence children, and so the status of the parent, because it influences where the child grows up, determines something about the status of the child, and so the model will unravel that way. Now, the structure of the model will have both the social influence, and you'll see there's certain markets aren't going to be prevalent. I say there's market frictions. All that's going to mean is that certain types of borrowing are not allowed in the model, and there will be intuitive reasons for that. Okay, so that's going to be the approach. And what I'm going to do, and I should say this model is not aesthetically unpleasing. It's got a lot of moving parts, so I'm just going to talk through the moving parts and then give you the results. So the way the structure of the model is going to have very, very simple demography. And what it means is there's going to be a fixed set of family dynasties. There's not going to be any assorted, there are no marriages. There's going to be asexual reproduction within each dynasty. So each person, a person is born, lives two periods, and then dies. In period one, called childhood, a person receives human receives educational investment and grows up in a neighborhood. In period two, as an adult, the person receives an income, forms neighborhoods with others, educates her children or her child, and then dies. And so the point of stripping down the demography this way for the non-economists is that what it's going to do is just have this very precise distinction between childhood and adulthood, in which childhood is this period in which investment transpires, and then adults do something which will affect the investments in the kids, and then you can sort of then trace out the dynamics of the family dynasty. And so the sort of question I'm going to be interested in is, suppose I have two family dynasties, I look at the income difference between you two, I could then make a prediction about the income difference between your offspring, your grandchildren, so on and so forth. And I might want to think about the persistence of the contemporary income inequality. Will there be a rank reversal of where you are in the population? Will there be a diminution in expected value across generations of contemporary gaps and things like that? And so, you know, as a piece of, you know, of tiny piece of mathematics, it's going to be this very simple time series. Each family is going to have a time series in which there's going to be given some shocks today and wherever the family was today, an outcome for the kids tomorrow, so on and so forth. And so I'm going to trace out the dynamics that way. All right, the second assumption is going to have to do with preferences. And the idea is going to be that each parent cares about two things. The two things a parent cares about in this model are going to be consumption as an adult and the income the child will have as an adult. Now, I'm not going to be around when the parent's not around when the child's an adult, and so they are going to have beliefs about it. And so here they're going to care about expected utility. Very important, we're going to assume at the begin in the model a Cobb-Douglas preference structure. This is actually incredibly important for working the model out. And the reason for that is that this preference specification has a very happy feature, which is that everybody, you know, remember from basic micro, under Cobb-Douglas preferences, budget shares are constant. In other words, the fraction of my income I spend on A versus B, I will always keep that constant. What happens is, as prices, relative prices change, it tells me the amount of the stuff I buy. That's going to be very helpful, because when I want to work out the political economy of the model, I need to deal with voting equilibria, which can be tricky, and so this is going to make it trivial. All right, so I want to distinguish, so really two points. One is asking, what are the arguments that should go in the preferences? And second, what's the functional form? You might say, why did I put it the income? Some models would say that I care about my consumption utility and the expected total utility of my child. That's a different formulation. Yet another formulation, this is actually the one Gary Becker used in his initial work, was that as a parent, I care about my consumption and the human capital of my child. The reason that the principal reason for doing this is that the income is the budget constraint for the offspring, and so I could sort of think of that as the thing I want to maximize for my child. The real reason is it's much easier to work with a model in which I don't have to think about the recursion into the future. Okay. Second idea is going to be the following, and that is that so children grow up in neighborhoods, and so my income as an adult is the product of a constant. The human capital that's embodied in me as a child, and some sort of luck, labor market luck. Okay, by itself, if I just said to you, human capital and luck determine my income, that would be standard operating procedure. What is, again, important here is the functional form. Now, why is the functional form a big deal here? It's because I'm going to have one input, and there's constant returns of scale here. This model will have what is going to allow for growth in the family incomes. And that's actually a theme of the paper, is asking questions about mobility in environments in which incomes are growing across generations. And it turns out the question, actually, even thinking about mobility, you have to ask different questions when you allow for growth. Why is that? It's because in growing economies, the support, which has almost all the probability mass for the incomes because it's getting bigger, there's many more trajectories for the family dynasties to go, and whether or not they traverse each other, et cetera, all of that is completely different in growing environments versus stationary. So that's going to be a theme in the paper, that if you look at dynamics in growing environments, you actually get more persistent inequality than otherwise. All right, and the shocks, and when I talk about this unobserved heterogeneity, it can be at both at the neighborhood level and the individual. That's not going to matter. All right, this model, I should add it parenthetically. I really did. The classic model of intergenerational mobility is due to Gary Becker and Nigel Tomes, a 1979 Journal of Public Economy paper. We sort of self-consciously mimic a lot of aspects of that model because we want to contrast that model to this one, where the Becker model, in which families make direct investments in their children, but in this model, everything is social. So that's why we sort of wanted to start that way. So here's where something that we don't get, for example, Becker-Tomes. There is the model in this stage. We'll do it in the next stage. We'll have it back in. But here it's out. There is no private investment in children. There is no private education. The only thing that happens is that you live in a community that provides something called a school. And so what that means is that the budget constraint for an individual is that my income either is devoted to consumption or taxed away. The assumption is that in a neighborhood there are linear income taxes. Okay, a better or richer model would focus on property taxes, which are the actual revenue generating process, but you see adding a market for real estate would make the thing intractable. So that was your question on simplification. That one is too much. Now you might say, why did you assume the taxes are linear? Well, both obviously it's for simplicity, but keep in mind when you have not only your taxes, how difficult it might be to even talk about equilibrium neighborhoods. Because after all, if we form a neighborhood and you're the richest person, what are we going to do? We're going to set a nonlinear tax which taxes away 100% of your income. So you see, but then you wouldn't be in the neighborhood. So in other words, we need to put some structure on the taxes because this is kind of, knowing where the end game is, because I want to actually be able to talk about equilibrium configurations where we don't have expropriation at the end. And so linear taxes let us do those types of calculations. Okay. So the way this model is going to work is that neighborhoods collect taxes, and what the taxes do is they're like a pool of resources that can be used for education. What I want to then say is that the money for education translates into an educational input that is a function of the pool of resources available and the number of kids to educate. So P is the population of the neighborhood. Okay, so at one level, that's a triviality to say, isn't it? That if there are more kids, it costs more to provide a certain quality of education. What's not trivial here is that there's an assumption of some scale economies to education. One question is why would rich families have less rich neighbors? After all, if I have a model of endogenous neighborhood formation, I got to sort of figure out why I don't end up with an equilibrium where every family is in its own neighborhood. I could just assume that's impossible. In other words, I could fix the number of neighborhoods ex ante and say there has to be heterogeneity. But since the whole logic of this exercise is to understand how segregation endogenously emerges, I don't want to have any ex ante requirements for integration or segregation. So keeping that in mind, if I'm going to have all this flexibility on the number and size of neighborhoods, I'm going to have some stuff built into the model that creates incentives for agglomeration for multiple family neighborhoods. There's lots of ways to think about it. We could think about the amenities that are associated with larger communities. So as I was saying, that one of the great things about being in a place like Chicago is that they're the incredibly good places to see live magic. You just can't have that in Madison because it has a tenth of the population. So there's all these amenities that could be very exciting. Could make this a desirable. Could create that type of agglomeration preference. Again, that's kind of outside the domain of the model. So I just really want to say there's some incentives to have neighbors because of the sharing of human capital costs. Okay. So human capital in the model is going to be the product of two factors. One is the educational input. That's the role of the schools in the model. And then the second is, I'm going to assume the productivity of the educational input depends on the average income in the neighborhood. The average is simply a shorthand for saying there are social interactions, or there's something about the distribution of types amongst the parents that matters. And I want to remember, I have in my head, I'm going to try to keep track of the income levels in the, across the dynasties over time. And so I want to make all the assumptions about spillovers, et cetera, always about income, because at the end I want to work out a stochastic process for income so I can trace it out. So in that sense, I really, you know, this is a black box. There's no effort to justify outside of saying that, there's ways I could in principle justify. We don't want to do that here because the objective is to have the income dynamics mapped out. What this really tells us is that there's two channels why neighbors matter. The first is affluent neighbors provide resources for schools. At a given tax rate, I would love my neighbors to be rich, because they're going to provide more inputs. That's the political economy route, which we talked about earlier. The second is the pure social route, which is there's something about the distribution of types in a neighborhood. Here, the sufficient statistic for the types is the mean that is creating this social influence, which facilitates things. Once again, the devil in the details is there's a lot of things are multiplicative in levels, which means they're additive in logarithms, and that's what's going to allow me to look at income dynamics across a growing in a growing economy. So what's missing, of course, are two things now. One, the rules that determine the taxes, and who lives in what neighborhoods. We're actually almost done. We've got most of the details here. We have the preferences for individuals, and we have the rules by which resources or incomes are converted into consumption, which we don't care about, so I'll never talk about it again, but we'll determine the educational inputs, which will interact with the social interactions and produce the human capital, which produce the next generation's incomes. So the assumption here is going to be actually pretty trivial, and that is that neighborhoods are going to be what are called core configurations. And what they say is that any set of families is allowed to form a neighborhood. Now, you give it a marginal bit of verisimilitude, they can set a minimum income barrier. That's kind of the idea of neighborhoods. That is not necessarily, you might say, well, that's a weird way to do it. There's another way to do it, which is I could say each neighborhood has a rental price to be a member. And so the point is that the core configuration idea cuts away from a complication, which is demonstrating the existence of supporting neighborhood prices for the segregation of neighborhoods by income. What I can tell you is in previous work that this model is based on, which I did myself, I was able to show that under assumptions similar to these, there is a supporting set of prices, so that the core configuration is also a price equilibrium. We're pretty close to proof for it here, but we're not there, and so right now I'll put it as a conjecture. But I want to be upfront. That's something that I think, again, on the aesthetics is unappealing, which is that we'd prefer to be able to show that it's prices that are supporting degrees of segregation of neighborhoods. That said, there is an important role for thinking about non-price mechanisms associated with neighborhood segregation, which I think is somewhat underappreciated. What do I mean by that? That's what zoning restrictions are about. So in other words, if you look at when I owned a house, I lived in a neighborhood which was a development, and there was a rule for the development. Everybody who owned a lot there in a house signed a contract saying this house can only have one family living in it. Okay. And what it meant, in other words, is that you were not allowed, there was a ban on multifamily units in this particular community. So why was that ban there? So there'd be no apartment buildings. In other words, it was a mechanism that was trying to create a certain level of necessary affluence to live in the community. And so what I want on the table is that zoning restrictions are extremely important in understanding contemporary levels of economic segregation. And so in my view, it's not so obvious to me that just relying on prices is sufficient, because we know the prices themselves can be manipulated by zoning restrictions. I believe this is still true, but I can't swear to it. There was a point in time where Woodside, California did not have its own fire department, and it required every family to have a swimming pool that was large enough to have the amount of water necessary if you were to have to put a fire out. And so Woodside is a city that people like Joe Montana and Joan Baez were living in. So my point is there's lots of cute examples of wild zoning things to create very very isolated and expensive neighborhoods. But the most common one in the United States, which is very serious, is the multifamily dwelling restriction. So I just put that on the table that, as I said, there's going to be a bit, excessively simple way to allow families to form neighborhoods. What I would say is I think that introducing prices, it will turn out to be feasible as long as there isn't a physical market for land. So in this model, neighborhoods are really clubs. If there was a physical market for land and these units were moving around, then there would be things like capital gains that have to be calculated. And that, that would be a level of complication. I just don't know if the model could be rendered tractable. All right, so the final assumptions is going to be the taxes, and this is the political economy. Taxes will be determined by the median voter in each community. I should say that's actually a sloppy way to write it. The rule for equilibrium taxes is a majority voter rule, and then what that means is a tax is an equilibrium if there does not exist a fixed alternative, such that in a head-to-head election, the alternative would win. All right. In this model, it will just the background, the existence of equilibrium tax rates is that's tricky business. This is where impossibility theorems and the like come into play. And so the way that one would think about this is that what will ensure existence of an equilibrium tax rate is when preferences are single peaked with respect to tax rates. So this is kind of basic social choice theory, because what you want in that case is the median voter's preferred tax rate. It could never be defeated by a majority, because if it's on this side of the median voter, a majority of these guys all vote no. If it's on this side, everybody here votes no. And so the trick, in other words, is to make sure that, to just rule out issues of non-single peakedness because and therefore ensure that the median voter's preferences will prevail. This model does more than that. Because the Cobb-Douglas assumption was used on preferences, everybody agrees on the preferred tax rate. You might say, how big a deal is that? It actually turns out that one has to be very careful to ensure existence of voting equilibria. And it's actually a way to see why this could be problematic is I haven't mentioned private schools, have I? Here, there's no demand for them because you can always form your own neighborhood. But in general, models that have public and private schools are canonical cases there was a young economist in the late 60s, I guess maybe it was 60 or 1970, called Stiglitz, who discovered that preferences wouldn't be single peaked in the presence of private schools, because what would happen is, if the taxes are too far away from the ones I want, what am I going to do? Withdraw my kids from the private school? And being a narrowly minded person, what's my preferred tax rate once I use a private school? Zero. And so that's the sort of thing one has to be careful about. Okay. Final piece of political economy. There is no borrowing in the model. Okay. This is an idea that that Glenn Lowry, first really formalized in his work on intergenerational mobility, which is a complementary model to the Becker-Thoms. And the idea is really, at some level, it's a triviality, if you think, because it is something the law entails. And that is, nobody can entail a third party to pay his or her debts. And so in private education models, it's just a way of saying the parents of very talented children who are poor cannot borrow money and say, my child will pay you back because I'll be so productive as adults. The same thing applies here, which is neighborhoods can't borrow money for education in the presence of the fact that there's no fixity of who the memberships are. So that's the sense in which one would say there's a friction. But I think that's it. Okay, that's the whole model. So, as I said, it has a lot of moving pieces. It's not particularly elegant, but what I want you to have in your head is, as I said, just this sequence. I'm an adult. I have one child. I have an income. Based on the distribution of the incomes in the population I live in, neighborhoods form. I end up in one of the neighborhoods. A tax rate is set. That educates my child. That education interacts with the distribution of types in the population, the mean, and determines how productive my child is. Next period, there's a bunch of incomes. They were determined by the educational inputs for all the children and the unobserved heterogeneity, which is called labor market luck. They reform neighborhoods. They go through the same procedure. And so what I want to do as the analyst is I'm going to basically try to, I'm going to look at pairs of families and trace the relationship between the incomes of a set of parents and the incomes of their descendants. Okay, but what's going to drive the transition mechanism every period is not just my income in isolation, it's my income as it interacts with other people's and determines what neighborhoods my children live in, or my child lives in. Okay, first proposition, which is really comes from the assumptions, but just the thing to have on the table, is there is a there was a uniform preference for more affluent neighbors in the model. In other words, I may like more neighbors, that's fine, but conditional on the number of neighbors, the richer the better. That is by assumption on the model. In other words, one reason for that is that the tax base increases. And the second is that the assumption on the nature of the social structure is that the benefits through the social channels are higher when the neighbors have higher incomes. So I could, you could think about reasons why that wouldn't hold. But we're also going to think about reasons why that feature of the model is plausible. So if it's labor market connections, it's not just knowing whether somebody about a job, it's about the type of job, so on and so forth. Right. One could have modified this if I wanted to keep track jointly of income and education to say that the social influences all work through human capital, and that one sounds a little more intuitive in terms of the strict monotonicity. That would not qualitatively change the results. That proposition tells us it's going to be trivial to figure out what the neighborhoods look like. And that is that I can even give you an algorithm for the construction of the neighborhoods. The equilibrium neighborhoods I can actually will have the could be constructed as follows. There's a realized distribution of incomes across the individuals in the population. You take the richest person, you're rich these days, so and you tell me, who are your preferred neighbors? If you could form any neighborhood you wanted, what would be your ideal? Well, maybe second, maybe third, maybe fourth. So you'll form your preferred neighborhood. We know that you always prefer richer, more to less affluent neighbors. So whatever your preferred neighborhood is, it's going to go income down to this level. This is the richest person, highest income person you want as a neighbor. I'm sorry, you're the highest person left out. That's the bad news. The good news is you get to form your preferred neighborhood amongst the residuals. You'll form some distribution. You're the last guy. You're the first one out. You form yours. If you go through that procedure, those are the equilibrium neighborhoods. And so what the trick is essentially is showing that any neighborhood that she thinks is ideal, everybody else in that neighborhood agrees it's ideal. And why is that intuitive? Because the only difference between you and me in that neighborhood, suppose you have more income than me and you let me in, you're paying more taxes than I am. So if it's the best for you, how could it not be the best for me? It's even better for me. So then, and it basically used that kind of elementary logic to show that if you go through this sequential form my best neighborhood thing, those will also be the equilibria. How do you do the price things? What you would then do is say, once I form those, show that the gap between the lowest income person inside, that what I would do is figure out the price at which you're happier to be in your neighborhood at whatever price is there versus hers. And that would be the price difference between the neighborhoods. And that's how you do the price equilibria. That is some, and so what you can show through the construction, as I said, is that you get a very simple proposition, which is there were only two things she could have said. One of them is everybody lives. She wants everybody to be her neighbor, or we would get induced strict stratification of the neighborhoods. That is actually an assumption that the next version has to get rid of. It's too extreme. Please. Well, so the example I want to give, when I was an assistant professor in Palo Alto, there were some apartments there that were absolutely horrible. I mean, really physically unpleasant units that had astronomically high prices or high rents. They weren't for graduate students. They were for immigrants. And in other words, that not just immigrants, but they were comprised of very poor people that were willing to pay any, very high fractions of their incomes to live in the Palo Alto school district. And so when I said that the assumption's too extreme, what the next version of this paper has to do is allow for heterogeneity in parents that will break the strict stratification. But there, and you can see, and I should say Dennis Apple has papers that, that do this, for example, because you want to allow an interplay of things. People have different willingnesses to pay. And so that needs to be respected in the context of these of the neighborhood formation. But I don't have that channel here. The sufficient statistics for everybody's heterogeneity is just their incomes. But I think there is another scope, which is that you have these periods where you have parents making these extraordinary sacrifices, and that is one of the ways to understand why there wouldn't be strict segregation by income. The other, of course, would be a richer housing market combined with ex ante setting of the community boundaries. I mean, here there could be any number of schools in principle, every generation, every number of school districts, and those things ruled out also induce heterogeneity. Okay, but this model, because it's so stripped down, that is going to have the strict strict results. Okay. Now, those two results by itself, so there's a very clean way to think about things. And so then an observation to make is, even calling these things propositions, I mean, reifies them as less trivial than they are. And that is, I now just have ways given these two, this background structure of thinking about conditional probabilities. In other words, I want to know the conditional probability given your income of your descendants' income. What are the things I'm going to have to know? I'm going to have to know what neighborhood they grew up in and your income. And then I'm going to have to know something about you, but then I would trace that out. And so the point is, I get these Markov processes, and they're kind of messy. And what makes the things quote-unquote messy is I can't look at each dynasty in isolation. I have to think about where the descendants are going to be relative to other descendants and what neighborhoods they're going to be in. And so that what that means is that the propositions trace, well, it means for me the propositions are going to look kind of wimpy. A very scientific term. Okay, the serious point is they're going to be phrased in weak language. In other words, it's not going to be able to, it'll say, this may happen, under these conditions, something may happen. All right, so here's one result. And so remember I said that maybe she put everybody in the same neighborhood. If she did that, there'd be no correlation between the parents and the kids, because everything was social. So the first question is, under what circumstances are there multiple neighborhoods? And if the proposition says that if you look at any income distribution, I can find a gap between rich and poor, richer and poor, such that the families above one threshold and the families below the other threshold will not live in the same neighborhood. Okay, and so in some ways you can see I really need a result like that. Basically says that with sufficient cross-sectional inequality, the neighborhoods start fissioning into multiple neighborhoods. The intuition is that the model had built into it these different forces for agglomeration versus segregation. I don't wish to there's no nobility in this model, so no desire to redistribute taxes to others, but I want to take advantage of certain agglomeration features. And so the way that it's built in the model, you get these threshold effects that you have enough cross-sectional inequality and suddenly multiple neighborhoods emerge, more cross-sectional inequality, more small neighborhoods, and the system will continue to fissure. And in some sense, that once you know that's true, then you can see that that's going to be the way that we get persistent inequality. So here's a result which I gave a hint to before. And that is, when we look across the equilibrium configurations of neighborhoods, not only do we know they'll always be stratified, we always know there'll be multiple neighborhoods if there's enough cross-sectional inequality, we also know that there's a certain sense in which these are going to be inequality-maximizing configurations. So if I ask the question, of all the configurations of neighborhoods, what configuration will maximize the expected income gap between the offspring of the richest family and the offspring of the poorest family? It is subject to a size constraint, the equilibrium. Now, unlike the Becker marriage model, complementarity is not saying that nothing's efficient here necessarily, but nevertheless, it's the same idea. The key was, these structured social interactions create incentives for segregation. Those incentives for segregation implicitly maximize differences between the endpoints. And so we got a mimicking of that Becker result. Now, I want to say unlike the Becker complementarity result, there is no efficiency to the equilibrium in these models. In other words, there's no claim about that. And I want to then very briefly digress to show you a result. Okay? So another paper I have in progress with Brock and Nath is called Dynamic Inefficiency of Assortative Matching. So I went through a big argument that said assortative matching is efficient in the presence of complementarity. That was a model without time. Here's a different question. Everybody with me? I have a group of kids. I'll make it concrete for the example. There's four children. They have initial ability levels. I'm going to put them in classrooms of two. So there's two classrooms, two kids each. The ability levels at time, so that's kindergarten. Grade one, ability is determined by where you started, plus what happened in the classroom, which is you were with a teacher and you were with another classmate. I can resort the students. Do the same thing here, 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 and here. Everybody with me? So I start with the kindergartners. I trace them to age 17. Every classroom exhibits complementarity in the sense that the marginal payoff to an increase in my ability is higher if I have a high ability peer. In other words, the transitions, I'm giving the Becker case. Remember the case where in the static model, assortative matching is efficient. I'm saying every year the classroom has complementarity. All right? The question is it efficient? And at the end of the day, remember, I'm a non-egalitarian policymaker. I want to maximize average ability among students. I don't care about the distribution. Everybody with me? Do I assortatively match? Sounds like I rigged the problem. I said everything had the strict complementarity in every period. My objective function was to maximize the sum, and hence the average. It turns out not necessarily. The dynamics changed the logic of the exercise. Here's how to think about it. If you're a bunch of 16-year-olds, there's only a static problem left, isn't there? What do I do with you in the last year? Or 17-year-olds, excuse me. Okay? Then I assortatively match. That's the Becker result. But what about the kindergartners over here? My objective is not to maximize your skill level on average at the end of the age of five, is it? My objective is to maximize your skill level at the age of 17. So in fact, even though, as I say, I made the most extreme assumptions in favor of the Becker efficiency result, what can happen is the following. And that is that for every period before 17, my objective is not to maximize the average, it is to construct the most favorable distribution across individuals such that when I get to the static problem, that was the best distribution for the assortative matching. And so what can happen in these models is when you think about the dynamic consequences of classroom tracking, to make it a little more concrete, or assortative matching, is that kids can get lost. If you start immediately assortative matching, you can end up putting kids on these bad trajectories. So by the time they're 17, they have very low skill levels. So whatever happened to them is going to not be good. And even if it is efficient to assortively match them at 17, it was a very undesirable set of skill levels they brought to the table. And so the thing I wanted to emphasize is that, and this is a dimension where really this has not been studied at all, is that in thinking about the efficient, these sort of matching efficiency, equity trade-offs, et cetera, the results are really living in static environments. Dynamic environments, there's a different question. We have an endpoint we care about, and we want to think about the whole population of children and not the fact we don't care about the variance or the distribution or any inequality at 17 is immaterial. What matters in all the previous periods is that the entire distribution becomes relevant. And even under what I'm calling the non-egalitarian objectives, I just want as much human capital in the population as possible, so on and so forth, you end up with a very different view of the need for integration of different skill types across these trajectories. And so that's why assortative matching will be dynamically efficient, even if it's statically efficient. All right, so I'm almost done. So I just wanted that on the table. These are the final results. All right, so I now want to talk about persistent inequality. So the first thing I said you're the two. So I want to look at the expected growth rate of income between you and your child versus you and your child. what we can show is, subject to a group size condition, which is not interesting, if you're in a higher income neighborhood than her, the expected value of the growth is higher for your kid than your kid. And again, that's intuitive. I built in the political economy and the social interactions say that. It doesn't say that you're necessarily going to grow. It just says that whatever the growth rate is, it's better to have richer neighbors. So let's start with that. Now, consider the following. Everybody with me? I start with the initial configuration of families. By the way, I didn't reveal something. She's the richest person in the population. You're the poorest. Okay, so I'm going to take the ratio of your incomes. What I want to do now is think about the ratio of your descendants' incomes. Okay? It turns out in this model there is a positive probability that the ratio of your incomes will be a lower bound on the ratio of the descendants. In other words, this is as close as you're getting in a percentage sense. So what's going on intuitively? Well, as a mathematical object, you could think about if there's a crisscross in the family dynasties, that's like hitting zero. If I have a random walk with drift away from the origin, there's a positive probability I'll never hit the origin. There's always a positive probability I will. And that's the key about growth. In these growing economies, in expected value, we're getting increased inequality. But at every point in time, there's always a sequence of shocks that would reverse all of the ranks. So there's never a deterministic poverty trap. In fact, there's never an ex ante poverty trap. It's only ex post that you find out that this thing's happened. But what's happening is along the growing trajectories, because of the interplay of the political economy and the social interactions, which are by assumption, I get these disparities in growth rates, and that builds in a local generation T to T plus one instability in the income distribution. Once that's built in, there's a possibility that these trajectories never intersect. So I can so that's one result. Here's the 1% result, which basically says another thing that can happen in the model with positive probability, if there's enough contemporary inequality, the upper and lower tails decouple from the rest of the population, and they never rejoin. And so very poor people become isolated, very rich people become isolated, and you get this permanent fissioning of the population. And the final result is the Gatsby-like curve. And what it says is that in this model, there are income distributions where if you fatten the tails out, it slows down the rate of mobility. Now, the reason I had to say Gatsby-like is it's never guaranteed. What's key is that there will be levels of increasing inequality that increase the fissioning of the communities, hence more decoupling of subsets of the population, and that's what slows down inequality. And that's what I meant when I said it's a weak theorem, because I haven't given you much detail as to when it happens, but nevertheless, it's possible. So that is work in progress, as I said. What I want to emphasize is, I think that we need to get the stratification by prices worked out. That one I think is good. The second one, we sort of know how to do that. And that's going to be, and as I said, I think it's important to introduce heterogeneity in parental preferences, because part of the process of dynastic resilience is a generation that can makes a huge investment in the kids, and then has this longer run consequences. The third one, I don't think we can get into this paper, because I'm not sure at this point we can get the interaction of race and segregate and income into the model. The things to know is that the levels of racial segregation, residential segregation in the United States, are substantially higher, far higher, than can be explained as derivative from economic segregation. If you have two groups with different income distributions, economic segregation will induce racial segregation. There's much more going on. That's point one. There is some very limited evidence, non-existent, that measures of racial segregation are declining and measures of economic segregation are increasing. So there's been some argument that the nature of segregation is changing. But I think obviously in understanding patterns of neighborhoods, this is first order. And the final thing is to understand something what I'm going to call the fractal nature of segregation. That's just the observation that within these aggregates communities, we also know segregation occurs. This is really what you were asking about. And that is that you look at the interactions of children or adolescents within a school. There's a substantial intra-school segregation, which is going to be sitting there below the inter-school segregation, and sort of trying to think about that as, I think, another level of richness that's needed. But that's, as I said, this is all work in progress, but what I wanted you to sort of see from the analysis is by taking this idea of the social structures and the political economy, embedding that in the growth environment, we sort of got the multiplicity ideas and the segregation ideas interacting to produce, you know, sort of interesting inequality dynamics. So let me stop there. Thank you.